Board of Zoning Appeals for Clayton, Ohio to order September 3rd, 2024. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGinnis?
Here.
Ms. Hunter?
Here.
Mr. Madewell?
Here.
Ms. Caldwell?
Here.
And Mr. Johnson?
Here.
Yeah, I think I'll go through and kind of run through what we're going to be doing tonight. We have a full crowd, so let you know. I'm going to be administering oath to everybody who wishes to speak in front of us tonight. And when you do, we're going to want you to come up to the podium, state your name, your address, and then address any questions or any comments to the board. Okay? So that's the way we're going to be doing it. I'll be calling the agenda items, and staff will present the case, give a summary of the overview. We're going to ask the applicant to come up, stand at the podium, and see if they would like to add anything to what staff presented. Be asking any board members then if they have any questions of staff or the applicant during that time. At that point, we're going to ask for a motion and a second to open the floor to public comments. We'll have a roll call of that too. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to make comments, okay? Please, if your comment's been made by a previous speaker, don't repeat it. No sense in doing that. We can hear and we do understand. Direct again your comments to the board, not directly to the applicant. The applicant will have a chance to respond to the comments received at the end. Once the floor has been closed to public comment, no additional comments can be made. We're going to ask for any public comment in favor or against the applicant, and then see if staff has any comments that were provided prior to the meeting. We'll ask for a motion and a second to close the floor to public comments. Again, we'll go through a roll call. We'll ask the applicant if they'd like to rebut any public comment that has been received. So they'll have an opportunity to address that. We'll ask if any further discussion among the board members. And we'll ask board members then if they would like to provide the findings of fact for the case. What I mean by findings of fact? Well, we got a couple of instruments in front of us tonight. We've got a conditional use and we've got three variances, okay? Conditional use and the variances have specific requirements in the zoning code that they need to follow, okay? And those are what we're gonna be doing the evaluation against. We're not gonna be evaluating against a motion, we're gonna be evaluating against what our findings are. And those findings deal with the presentation of the applicant against the code, and then we'll work from there. If there's any problem with the way we rule tonight, that's fine. You can talk to your city councilman, you can talk to the mayor, but the only recourse to us is to take it and file a motion in the Common Pleas Court, okay? That's how you're gonna get our motion tonight overturned. So I wanna make sure that's clear, okay? And that's what we're gonna be talking about tonight. After all that, we'll ask for a motion and a second to approve conditions or disapprove the applicant's request, and again, we'll go through a roll call. So that's our process, okay? That's the way the process works. We do have four cases tonight. They could go on for a little bit of time. Nobody wants to stay up until after midnight listening to me drone. So let's keep it civil, and let's see if we can get through this, okay, folks? So anybody that likes to or wants to or thinks that they might want to talk tonight, either as an applicant or for a application or against an application, please stand and raise your white hand because we're going to swear you in. Even if you think, okay? All right, do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you may give before the Board of Zoning Appeals will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? If so, say I do. Thank you very much. Okay, first item on the agenda tonight is the minutes of the previous meeting, and these will be the minutes for the July 2nd, 2024 Board of Zoning Appeals meeting. Do I hear any additions, corrections, modifications to the minutes as they were distributed prior to the meeting tonight? Do we hear a motion?
Move to approve the minutes of the July 2nd, 2024 meeting.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. New business. Tonight, CU24-01, a request for conditional use to allow a halfway house in a Main Street District MSD zone at the property located at 2627-2629 North Main Street. Staff? Ellen?
Good evening. Introduction to the application. Application number CU24-01 was received on July 31st, 2024. The request is for a conditional use, specifically for the use of a halfway house. The applicant is Iris Blanchard, who is an agent of Mindful Soul Therapeutic Solutions, LLC. Public notice was printed in the Eaton Register Herald on August 21st, 2024, and letters to property owners within 300 feet of the subject property were postmarked on August 16th, 2024. The subject property is 8627 to 8629 North Main Street. The parcel is M601631301186, and there is an approximate area of 0.2468 acres at the site. It is currently zoned MSD, or Main Street District. Here's a map of the general location. Everything highlighted here is within 300 feet of the subject property. And here's a map of a more specific location. You can see here the address range is for two structures on the property. Analysis of the request. The applicant desires to operate a halfway house at the subject property. The applicant is the executive director of the intended business, Mindful Soul Therapeutic Solutions, LLC. The applicant desires to use both structures for the intended halfway house, the larger primary structure for the residence, and the smaller accessory structure for an office space of the business. The requested conditional use is from section 1121.05 of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code. Section 1121.05.b says halfway houses may operate as a conditional use in any single or multiple family residential district as long as said house meets the requirements set forth herein. The applicant indicates the purpose of the structure is for individuals to live in a sober living house. The applicant indicates the facility is intended for individuals recovering from substance abuse disorders. The applicant indicates the facility will serve as a transitional residence for individuals to reintegrate into society and maintain sobriety. The applicant indicates they intend to comply with all relevant local, state, and federal regulations. You can see here, this is what the applicant submitted for a site plan. We have the Montgomery County Auditor's Office general information pages and pictures of the property from 2012. Here's some more pictures from anywhere from 2012 to 2018. We can see the accessory structure on the left intended to be used for the office space, and then the primary residence on the right intended to be used for the residence. Here's some more pictures of different perspectives from the property, and then an oversight with, again, the parcel boundaries. And then again, an overhead view with parcel boundaries, and another page from the Montgomery County Auditor's Office webpage. Here are the individual site plans for the rooms that were submitted by the applicant. And here's a few more. And one last one. Code guidance. The applicable code section that addresses the MSD zoning classification is 1111.15. Section 1111.5.D regulates permitted uses and conditionally permitted uses within the CMX zoning classification. The applicable code section that addresses general regulations for properties in Clayton is 1121. Section 1121.05 regulates the standards for halfway houses in any district where conditionally permitted. In addition, the board should refer to section 1141.08, which outlines the procedures for obtaining a conditional use in the Planning and Zoning Code. Staff recommendation. After evaluating the applicant's request, staff recommends that the Board of Zoning Appeals consider the following aspects of the request. The applicant did not include pertinent information with a request to be reviewed by this board, namely the identification of other care facilities within 2,500 feet of the proposed halfway house, number of intended residents of the facility, sponsoring agencies, operational and occupancy standards, and detailed plan for services and programs and licenses from pertinent governmental units. The property owners of the facility have been suspected of renting the facility out as a short-term rental party location and have been unresponsive to the City of Clayton staff in all instances when contacted with concerns about the property. You can go one more. And that's what I have for you.
When did you get out, that last item that you had out there, what is the property owner think about that?
We have not been able to reach the property owner. The chief of police and several other police officers have tried to gain contact with the property owners. Unfortunately, it's owned by an LLC, and the LLC is located out of Columbus. There has been no response whatsoever from the property owners when tried to be contacted. Not typically. Typically, the owner of the property is listed in full. We can only show you what we receive, and if it appears to be stamped, then we have to process. It is the same number that Chief of Police and several other police officers have contacted, and they've left several messages for the property owner, but they've never received actual contact with the property owner. It's supposed to be incumbent upon the applicant. We do have a list somewhat. So if somebody operates a residential care facility or other care facility, they can contact the fire department for an assessment. They don't necessarily have to come to Clayton staff, although they should. So I contacted the fire department and got their list and then compared it to the list that we have in office. And I didn't identify anything within the city of Clayton, but I don't know from Butler Township or city of Inglewood.
Too, because the application is requiring certifications, not necessarily that we could get them, but that we have them in hand.
Mm-hmm.
I did see some recommendations, or at least some notes in there about going to college and getting degrees, but I didn't see any certifications in there. It seems a bit incomplete there. How do we typically handle that?
So when there's not enough information, you guys have the option to table it and let the applicant gather that information and then come back for reassessment, or to deny it or process as is. We did receive three certification, their wall certifications, stating that the applicant was licensed in a couple different areas and received a degree from Sinclair. And I included those with, I think, your packets this evening, but not within the presentation this evening.
Okay. And typically, I know for facilities that we've seen in front of the board, we'd have engineering drawings and we'd have good site maps to really tell us exactly what's going on. You know, these hand-drawn ones are rather risky, to say the least. Do we should expect that, right?
I would say so. It's not totally rare for me to receive applications for other zoning certificates that are hand-drawn. It's just whatever somebody has available to them. Typically, if we need to, we can include a scale for it so that we can measure items on the map. We did not receive that information from the applicant.
Okay, thank you. And then typically, again, in the past, and, you know, forgive me, but I've been on this board for a while, you know, we would have an operating manual. We would have indication of history that yes, we've managed these type of facilities in the past. Here they are. I didn't see any of that in our packet either.
That is correct, and staff has not received that information either.
Okay. All right. One thing about a halfway house that I've noticed is in our I did some homework too. Our definition of a halfway house in the zoning code is a facility where it's at the whim or the relief or the pleasure of the common police court or a police agency or some rehabilitation or facility to take inmates that are being released and place them in the home. There's no screening involved. Is that true? Is that your understanding too?
Not from the city. There's no screening there. It would be the sponsoring agency's detailed plan where you would find that information.
And when it comes to sponsoring agencies, did you see any notification of that?
The only indication of a sponsoring agency I saw was that the applicant is an agent of the Mindful Souls Therapeutic LLC.
Wow, and you may not even know this, the answer to this question, but I looked, tried to find Mindful Soul LLC, and I couldn't really find anything out there. And I'm wondering if that is maybe a framework in which people would work to try to put one of these facilities together. Is that your understanding?
My assumption is that the applicant is probably still putting together the LLC and creating the business at this point. So it might not have a lot of history there and might not be able to be located online at this point.
Okay, that's fine. Because I know, for example, we had Airbnb come before us. We had a AA on that, administrative appeal. And part of that appeal was somebody wanted to have an Airbnb here in Clayton. They were found out because they were having parties, et cetera, et cetera. Looking into Airbnb, it was a lot of guidelines where people should do this and should probably do that. There wasn't any shalls. There wasn't any controls that were built into that framework. You know, and I look at the risk of this type of a conditional use. We need to have pretty tight controls. I didn't see any evidence of that presented to us.
Staff has not received that information either.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to kind of touch base on those things, you know, to make sure that I was standing on the same ground you're standing on when I was reading through this.
I see it's called a sober house and a halfway house, and both those are a little different. It's my understanding. Which one is this going to be? Do you know?
This would be classified as a halfway house.
So it's not going to be a sober house, but a halfway house.
Correct.
Okay, I think I'm about exhausted here. Any other questions on the board for staff this time? Thank you. Okay, is the applicant for this conditional use here? Could you please come to the front podium and state your name and your address, please?
My name is Iris Blanchard. I reside at 329 Imogene Road, Dayton, Ohio, 45405.
And I'm Nia Blanchard. I reside at 30 Glen Haven Road here in Clayton, Ohio.
Okay. Thank you for your questions. I really appreciate your inquiry. Obviously, you have had a lot of experience in terms of people establishing businesses in the community. I first want to clarify my credentials. I actually did graduate from Sinclair Community College. I graduated with a degree in community-based corrections. I received an undergraduate degree from the University of Cincinnati in addiction studies, and I hold a master's degree in professional counseling. I'm a licensed professional clinical counselor. I have established Mindful Souls Therapeutic Solutions. It's been established since 2019, in which I provide counseling, and I also in mental health counseling to really from age 5 throughout the lifespan. In addition, I am a behavioral health therapist part-time at Dayton Children's Hospital, in which, of course, I provide therapy to children as well and adolescents. So with respect to my credentials, I can provide the additional information that you requested. That is not a problem. With respect to Nia Blanchard, my daughter, she can also provide insight as to what her credentials are as well.
All right, so my name is Nia Blanchard. First and foremost, this is a passion of mine and my mother's, just addiction studies. I'm CDCA, Chemical Dependency Counselor Assistant. I also served in the military for the Air Force, to be exact, for 4 years. I'm also, I was the human resource manager at Haven Behavioral Health. I've also worked at Nova Behavioral Health as a CDCA, as well as Eastway. So I've been kind of doing it for a while myself, and decided to kind of go into business with my mother, because again, this is just a passion of ours, so.
Careful.
Watch out, facilities management.
Now, with respect to, with regards to what it is that we are want to establish at 8627 and 8629 North Main Street, it's a recovery house, not necessarily transitional housing. Mr. Maywell, you are correct, there are a difference in terms of transitional housing versus recovery houses. So I wanted to clarify that. Secondly, there were some other additional questions that you had, but I do want to address that we are in the process. We are in the middle stages in actually in the process of the Ohio Recovery House, which is the arm basically that they do the accreditation. We're not trying to just get licensure, we're trying to be an accredited facility in which we're able to have oversight, not only just from the local level, which we definitely encourage, but also the state level as well. That's what we are in the, that's what we have applied for, and we are awaiting someone to come out and look at the facilities in that regard as well.
And the zoning is a part of that, so that's a part of
yes.
The certification becoming zoned. So that's why we're pursuing that as well.
So I know there was some other additional questions that you have, and I do apologize. Could you repeat some of your questions?
I'll do what I can.
Okay, thank you.
When it comes to accreditation groups generally would come in and they'd want to see an operation.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Do you have a handbook?
I do have a handbook, and I could provide that handbook. It's a very detailed handbook. One of the things that I had to go back to clarify that the Ohio Recovery House, it with respect to medical cannabis use. So I explicitly, because we are a recovery house, we will not be allowing medical cannabis use or any type of cannabis use in our facility, because I think that's important in terms of what we're doing with respect to, of course, recovery house. But we also, what attracted us also to the property is that We are actually in the process of a meeting with Dr. Mubarak across the street there. He's with Heartland Therapeutics, in which he's an addiction specialist, also a medical doctor as well. So we, our goal, of course, is to partner with him. In addition, what we're trying to, what our intent is to have a women facility, because that is a, that's a huge need in our community. And again, right across the street, there is a women's, a person that specializes in women's health as well, at Horizon.
Are you aware of any other facility in the area, the immediate area?
I am. I'm aware of not necessarily a facility in the immediate area. I am aware of Fresh Start that is down the road, and they do have an established, they have an established treatment program. So I am aware of Fresh Start in the area. But in terms of actually a recovery house, I'm not aware of any recovery houses in the area.
Okay. Is that, is Fresh Start a an outpatient type of a facility?
Yes.
Yeah, but you're proposing a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week facility?
Yes. Yes.
What kind of staffing are you, profile do you have? We don't see any.
Yes, our staffing profile will include not only a house manager, a case manager. We're actually looking at doing a level two. So it's going to require us to have a house manager, a case manager, and a peer specialist. In addition, we also will be contracting with nurse, we also have a nurse practitioner, but also a registered nurse that also would be providing services within house as well.
And okay. I live across the street now.
Are you currently running a facility like this anywhere in the area?
No.
Okay, so this is your first shot out of the out of the box, if you will. Understand.
But I do outpatient behavioral health mental health treatment.
And the only reason I say that is because there's a difference between going to a hospital and practicing and having responsibility.
Absolutely.
Of being able to set up, manage, control, mm-hmm. you know, this type of facility, I would think.
Absolutely.
I worked at a residential myself, two residentials where they were there 24 hours, so I have a lot of experience in that area.
Okay, and can you describe the people that are the residents of that facility, please?
So, Nova Behavioral Health, that was more transitional housing, more so. But Haven Behavioral Health, where I worked previously, was inpatient, and they were, you know, addicted. I know with us and going through, you know, withdrawals, going through their changes, they were in the beginning stages, so it was pretty bad, okay, to say the least. But with the proper staffing and the proper therapeutic treatment, it's definitely possible. I've seen a lot of recovery. I've seen a lot of people come out, you know, better people. So that's the goal here. And I also wanted to add that I just lost my train of thought that fast. I'm sorry. I just lost my train of thought.
Can I ask a quick question?
Please.
It's my a little limited understanding, but in this field of recovery, addiction, counseling, and that sort of thing, it's kind of moving to that, isn't it? Where you're getting not just the recovery, you have houses now that people are going from the
absolutely.
Recovery. Yeah.
That is very prominent right now. Most facilities right now are offering that with their sober, with their treatment. So that's what I've learned from meeting with different facilities. Most of them have their own, sober living
sober
homes
living.
Attached to their treatments. So that's kind of the goal here with this business.
So this is a sober home then?
Yes, it's
okay,
sober.
Okay.
Yes.
Not halfway, but it's, okay.
Yes, sir.
So where are your patients going to be coming from? A licensed counselor that's
yes.
going to recommend they live in a facility?
Yes, so we will only take referrals for the most part,
okay.
Referrals from other treatment facilities and such, and we also, in recovery for, they will have to at least have 30 days recovery time. So that's, yeah, they would have to have a referral to get to us.
So your clients will be coming from?
Yes, already coming from treatment.
Already coming from facilities?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
That are being treated?
Yes, great question. Thank you for
okay.
that.
So this is a business, and there's different ways that group homes can get money. Are you planning to be funded by the state of Ohio, by insurance, or by private pay?
It would be a combination. We do intend to probably receive some monies through the state, but also too because of the fact that people that are, of course, that would be in the continuum of recovery. We have people, of course, that will require additional either step down treatment. So we do have the capacity to offer that treatment, and we will be, of course, billing through the secondary, you know, insurances, commercial insurances, plus Medicaid. Additionally, we also do have opportunity, of course, for individuals that can afford to actually private pay as well.
So the accreditation process that you talked about earlier is from the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction?
Yes, this is the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction. They actually utilize the Ohio Recovery House housing to actually do the actual accreditation piece for sober living houses. It's actually going to be a requirement, thank goodness, because I've seen some recovery houses that definitely probably would need some oversight, right? That they'll be requiring that for all sober living houses in 2025. So we're just trying to get ahead of the game and also making sure that we're doing everything, making sure we not only just following guidelines, but also making sure we are actually providing the services that that's needed, and that's going to move people towards recovery.
Could you do me a favor? Could you kind of help tell me the difference between a sober house and a halfway house? I think they're different. I mean, so I can understand. I think other people. I have a.
Okay, so. A sober living house, of course, is primarily for people that are in active treatment and or, you know, recovery or whatnot for substance use disorders. A halfway house, generally speaking, are people that's kind of stepping down from the criminal justice system. And not to say that they, too, don't have a need, but we are not necessarily, that's not what we're necessarily gearing our clientele from.
I think that's important because it's,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's been presented as a halfway house,
mm-hmm.
and I saw a sober house, and they
mm-hmm.
are different.
Yes.
And yours are going to be coming from treatment centers.
Yes.
Recommended. So nobody's going to be walking up off the street and say, hey, can
no.
I come?
When you guys say halfway house, I was back there like.
Yeah.
Well, and that's a point of contention that we need to talk through
yeah.
a little bit. I probably have a question to Ellen on that, because our definition of a halfway house, I found it. It's a facility owned and operated by an agency or an individual authorized to provide housing, food, treatment, or supportive services for individuals on supervised release and who have been assigned by a court to a residential home in lieu of placement in a correctional institution, or for individuals who've been institutionalized and released from the criminal justice system who have had alcohol drug problems, which makes operation in society difficult, and who require protection of a supervised group setting. That is different.
Yes,
when it comes
totally
to
different.
Clientele. So the application in front of us, Ms. Snyder, if you will, please, is for halfway house. These people are coming here talking about something entirely different. So I got a real problem with that right now. But having said that, I understand the need. I understand your purpose. I understand where you're coming from. And it makes sense, especially with all the news that we have about, you know, the problems that we have. And thank goodness we legalized marijuana for recreational use. Wasn't that a wonderful thing? Yeah, that just adds another stick to your fire. So Let me ask you, have you approached Premier Health or Kettering Health or maybe Children's where you've been to see if they would sponsor you in a sober house environment? They may be able to give you some leverage. They may certainly give you some procedures. And for your first time out of the box, it may be an easier way for you to go. I'm just throwing that out there for you to consider.
No, I haven't. And thank you for bringing that, because definitely it's definitely something to consider. And we'll take that under advisement. Thank you for that.
I hope you do, because the way the application sits in front of us right now, I'm probably about 95% convinced you're going to be disappointed in what we're going to have to say at the end. I don't want to do that. I don't want to throw fire on your flame. Mm-hmm. I understand where you're coming from, and I understand your experience, your training, mm-hmm. and your need. But I think that if you approached it maybe a little different way, mm-hmm. it may be productive for you. Especially if you do get a sponsorship, you know, because you have the background, you have the education, you have the experience, you have the need, and they have the need too, because they're the ones then that are going to provide clients to you that you want.
Absolutely.
Rather than have somebody released that's been through and, oh, by the way, you know, this guy or gal's got a real problem, so mm-hmm. we're going to give them to you. I think you'd have more success if you went that way. Just a thought. What do you think about that?
Okay, and thank you for that. One of the things that we have put in place is an advisory board, if you will, of other providers in the community that do have established recovery houses. So we actually have kind of a mentor system and as well as a checks and balance system on a local level in terms of providing us with guidance as to what this should look like.
I like that. There's nothing wrong with the board. You know, we're a board of five people, but it's our collective thoughts that help us arrive at good decisions. And I think that working with a board like that would be good for you too. Get some additional ideas, get some additional thoughts. I like that. Yeah. So that sounds good too.
Forgive me for belaboring this, but I'm trying to be helpful. I think it's also very critical that we get this out to everybody, what the differences are and what you really are going to be,
mm-hmm.
and the path from where people are coming from and how they're getting to your facility and what you're going to do, versus I think, like I said, it was a little unclear.
Mm-hmm.
You're not a halfway house.
No.
But halfway house is all over this. And that was where my confusion was, but I thought I pretty much understood where you were coming from on that.
And to support Mr. Madewell's statement, you know, we don't have a sober facility in our code,
mm-hmm.
okay? Nor can we indemnify, or if you will, a conditional use to include this. You know, because it's going to fall under that conditional use. It's still going to be a halfway house, the way it sits right now.
Okay.
We have a satellite facility up here, Premier North.
Mm-hmm.
They may be a group that you want to contact as well.
Okay.
They may be somebody that would say, yeah, I could see a need for that. Because there is a need. There's a need for the service that you guys are trying to provide. I just want to make sure that it's done properly. And that's why we're up here. Is to not only make sure that you stay within the rules of the zoning code for the city of Clayton, but also to protect the community, the neighborhood, and to make sure that, you know, that use is a fit, okay, and that it goes hand in hand. What you're saying sounds like a fit. What I'm reading in the code, it could be different, and that's what we're trying to protect everybody from. And to make sure that we come to an amiable and a good solution.
Okay.
So that's why we're not putting you guys on the griddle, but we're kind of are.
You know what? This is important. Absolutely.
Yeah. Understand. You know, going through the application, you know, there were a lot of things that made me kind of scratch my head a little bit, because we were asking for plans. We were asking for specific plans. We've got very specific square footage for residences, you know, residents in the facility. You know, and hand-drawn, you know, sometimes it works, you know, if we're going to split off multiple acres of land for farming. But in this case, you know, kind of want a little more specifics. Yeah, there's a lot of that in there that I didn't see addressed. And that's why, you know, I'm being nice to you. No, that's not why. It's because you're a nice person. Why I'm being nice is I'd like for you to continue with that torch. I like the idea. I really do. And I think it's necessary. But I don't know if this is the vehicle and the venue and the way for you to approach it, is what I'm trying to say. Staff may have some ideas about that. Okay. I've thrown a couple out at you tonight, just kind of thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And if you are, you know, connected with Children's Hospital, mm-hmm. I know that the little ones that come in there sometime come from addicted moms.
Absolutely.
I know that. And, you know, that's a wonderful thing. You know, so you're right. You can go from way little age to, you know, mature people. Mm-hmm. Premier Health has a whole wing that's associated with this, and they do a lot of treatment. And when treatment's done, they may need, in some cases, to refer a resident, okay? That way you can be available and you can have that reference, plus you can perhaps get a working agreement with them to increase your knowledge, increase operational efficiency. Mm-hmm. Maybe they can rotate people through to help with your staffing. I mean, there's a lot of different possibilities there and opportunities that maybe you can take advantage of. And that's what I'm trying to get you to think about a little bit, because that may be the road to go. What do you guys think?
Well, I absolutely.
Thank you.
I agree, and I appreciate the tools that you gave. I think that is a great idea as well. We've done a lot of, we've been working on this actually for some years. So we have all our procedures. We have, you know, we have all this down to a T. I'm not sure, was it provided? Wasn't it provided?
No, the actual, because we were just asked for specific things, and we just provided what was asked. And even, it's funny that you had mentioned the square footage thing. We had asked if that's what we needed, and we were told that, no, all you need to do.
And then even the drawing, he said, well, it's just a house, whoever, I can't remember who I spoke with.
It was a gentleman.
I was asking as well, should we hire somebody to, yes, Seth. So that's who I spoke with in regards to the drawing, how we should proceed about it. He was like, well, because it's just a house, you know, you can even just have somebody go in and kind of draw the layout, and, you know, so that's why we went
there. Because otherwise, we always looking like, okay, well, maybe, because I do have
really
a,
expensive.
Well, but I do, I have a niece that's actually a
engineer.
She's actually helping.
But the property itself, you know, I saw the property, drove by it, looked at it a couple times, said, and you know, there's some work you're going to have to do to it. Number one,
mm-hmm.
Number two, it's leased. Do you know where the owner lives?
So I have, and I wish I could have printed it out. I have, so it's under land contract, which I believe is almost paid off. So I know the owner is. She's the president of the BDM Sisters Group Home, so she owns like four group homes in the Dayton area, and she's the one who leases it. So, and she actually wrote a letter. She just sent it to my email maybe an hour ago because she had been so busy, so I didn't get to print it out, regarding just her her advocating for it because her previous leasers were terrible. And she kind of is in the same line of work, so she was really advocating for it. So she has sent me an email and a letter to print out, but I didn't get to print it out.
Okay, well, that's okay. But there, she does have a local address?
Yes.
Now, on the affidavit, the sworn affidavit that you were going to lease from the property owner, that's a 614 area code, which is Columbus. Does she have a 614 area code?
Her telephone number. Because people telephone numbers are.
Yeah, because I know she has a business one, and then she also has the one that I talked to. Okay, no, this one is a 937 number.
You may want to keep digging and find out who actually owns this thing, because that is a and that's been a problem area. We have had reports from the city of Clayton police. They've had I think six calls down there. Nasty calls over the last 18 months. So that's about one every 3 months. you know, because of parties and all that kind of good stuff at that location. So I'm not sure that, you know, and if that property owner actually owns not only the property that you're thinking of leasing, but also the property next to it, and they're renting that out as a party house, that would not be conducive to residences that are trying to recover, I would think.
Oh, no. No, and actually, they're willing to lease both parts out as part of the recovery house, the sober living.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that you understood that there was some history at that place. And okay. Sometimes historical people would return to the places where they had fun in the past, so.
Okay.
It's possible.
Okay.
It's a risk that, you know, you're looking at.
One of the things also that we're collaborating with someone to do is the common areas, and also the back area have surveillance.
Maybe surveillance.
Surveillance. So there aren't, because my husband is in security, so he's kind of, you know, well versed as to what that's supposed to look like. So.
So we're also proposing doing the technology based. Everything's technology now. So they have like a sober living app that you can, basically they will have to, we could totally see everything they do from checking in, coming in. They will have to have a specific specific guidelines to when they can come and when they can go. And we could kind of see that here on the app. And the thing about sober living homes, if any policies or any rules are violated, same day, you get to pack your stuff and you can leave. So that's, you know, another plan of recourse there. Kind of how they did at Noble Behavior Health. So, you break a rule, you're out. So.
The people that you say are going to be there, are you going to have someone there 24 hours? Is somebody going to be there 20? Okay. Will they be living there as well?
They'll be your peer support specialist.
And you have a list of rules, and as I understand it,
yes.
The people who come in have to sign, like you're talking about.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Are the individual residents going to be available for work release? Is there any sort of a work program that they would be, encouraged to participate in?
Depending on where the continuum in terms of their recovery, they definitely be required to participate in a treatment service and or work. That's part of the requirement. Again, we will have a case manager as well, helping facilitate that, as well as providing transportation as well. So we have some things in place as to what this is going to look like.
Okay, that sounds reasonable too. I like your plans, but I'd sure like to see something in action.
That's what we're trying to do here.
I know that's what you're trying to do, and that's why we're talking. That's why we're having this discussion.
Right.
Okay. Any other questions from the board? Ms. and Ms. Blanchard.
Expecting to be, what's your maximum?
The max is 7, but starting out, we probably, don't plan on doing 7 starting out. So maybe, 4 starting out, just to kind of, see and how that goes before we kind of expand.
Plus the on-site person.
Yes.
Okay. You guys both going to be directly involved with it?
Yes.
Okay. So I actually live, like I said, it's on Glen Haven Road, so I'm like kind of counter corner right to it, so I have a direct line of sight. So, yeah, I'll be involved, and I'll also be running and facilitating a group. They're required to have a certain number of groups throughout the week, certain number of treatment time with a therapist, certain time with caseworkers.
That will be done.
We'll be having a weekly meeting.
House meeting.
House meetings.
The counseling be done on site there as well?
Yes, it would be in the
other structure.
The other structure,
so
the smaller structure. Yes.
It's wondering, curious.
I think
yeah.
The party took out a window. So we'll have to get that.
So we're in the process again that.
So the counseling will take place in the separate facility, so
yes.
They'll be separate as well. Okay.
You said the party took out the window.
Yeah.
Any other questions for the applicants? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I just had one quick question. One question that I think will potentially come up, maybe in the public comment by neighbors. You've talked a lot as far as the residents who would be at the facility. Is there any chance that you are going to have individuals with potentially violent criminal pasts?
No, that's actually as part of our
application process.
And part of our what we look at in terms of who's going to be actually who we will be able to who we will accept into our facilities or into our home.
Could you maybe just go through the flow? I mean, okay, somebody there's a Bob Mabel's drug counseling. I call you up and I say, I have someone I want you to consider. Is that the way that's going to happen? How are you get your referrals? And if you could walk us through that.
Okay. Could you repeat that? I'm sorry, I didn't.
How do you get your clients is basically,
oh.
Just walk through the flow of how you get, I think it would be interesting to know
well,
how you get that.
One of the things that we are proactively doing right now is actually collaborating, making connections with other treatment facilities. She has a rapport with people at NOVA, have people actually, I have a rapport with people in at Talbert House, things of that nature. So people that have actually gone through the initial stage of completed an inpatient treatment program that's ready to step down to a sober living, that's where we'll be getting the source of our referrals from.
And that would probably have some kind of criteria there like you were talking
yes,
about.
Yes, and it will have a criteria.
You know, you're going to see their background, they're not having any violence or
right.
whatever, and you can
or
say
any,
yes or no.
You know,
yeah.
abuse against, you know, children or, you know, those things. Those things will be actually, and that's part of our, if I may, and can send that piece over in terms of our standards of operations, if you will.
So
I
they will
be
vetted
over.
To some extent mm-hmm. gonna, before they get in.
Also was a supervisor for children's services for 25 years, so she's also very well known in that community as well.
Yeah, so we also, and I've
partner with,
we'll partner with, you of course, Chill, because I do still have a lot of contacts that, not that I forgot, but yeah, I worked at Children's Services for a number of years as well. So, yes.
Thank you. I appreciate your comments. Appreciate your passion.
Thank you.
Your focus.
And again, I appreciate your giving us some feedback that would be helpful for us as we fully develop what it is that
I like that, and you know what I also like is that you understand where you are,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's good
mm-hmm.
because you've got time to
mm-hmm.
reach out to these other folks, you've got time to think about another direction, you've got time to be able to find out if you can't leverage an existing medical facility
mm-hmm.
to be able to get the people that you want.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, what we're looking at is something that doesn't enable that.
Okay.
And that's an issue, and you'll find that, you know, when we go through and talk about things a little bit more. But I just want to make sure you're on the right track. I know that zoning and building and development can be difficult. I mean,
mm-hmm.
there's a lot of rules, a lot of regulations, just like in the medical, you know, field. It just goes on and on and on, seemingly. You've made good steps into this area, let's just see how the rest of the hearing goes.
Okay, and is it possible you can? I don't know. If I'm sure you didn't necessarily write it down, but if there's some way you can kind of give us a list of things that you feel like would be fruitful. meaningful for us in order for us to be able to be at a place where it will, you know, be conducive for.
You're talking about, I think that what I could do is I could get with staff. I've got some ideas,
okay.
You know, and we may be able to put something together, and you can talk with Ellen Snyder, okay. And maybe, you know, a week or so, you know, if we get our thoughts together. I personally wouldn't have any problem with providing a few ideas. You know, I came up with a few right off the top of my head tonight. That's all why right. I don't have any hair.
Appreciate it.
All ideas. But, you know, I think you're on the right track. I like where you're going, but I don't think this is a good fit for the application tonight.
Okay.
I really don't.
Are you mean as far as the halfway house?
Yes.
Yeah,
halfway house
well,
opens it up to the...
You're not a
I know you're not. I'm hearing that, and that's what I'm saying. Yeah, like I say, that 95% just went up to like 99.5% now for what we're going to decide. But nevertheless, I think you're on the right track. And I think that a medical facility, somebody big, somebody been around for a while, like Premier or like Kettering Health or like the, you know, Children's, absolutely, they would have some ideas on how to adapt to you and to take your ideas and then transform them into something that might be workable.
Okay.
And I think that would help you.
Okay.
And that's what I'm looking for here is to just not dismiss, mm-hmm. because you do have a good idea, and I think it is necessary,
mm-hmm.
and I think it's going to be getting worse before it gets any better, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you've got some good plans,
mm-hmm.
but I think that right now, for today, for what we're looking at,
okay.
You know, but yes, I will work with Ellen. I'll give her some ideas, and if you could work through staff,
mm-hmm.
I think that would be the good point of contact. Does that sound fair? Okay, great.
My only last comment again, I would really redefine what you really are, what you're really going to do, who you're going to serve, the customers, the clients you're going to serve, and how you're going to serve them. So it's so it's really clear to everybody, and it's not just.
There's an old saying about fitting a square peg in a round hole, and that doesn't work real well in zoning, I can tell you that right now. So I apologize for that misunderstanding,
no, that's perfectly
but
fine.
Nevertheless, this has been a very good dialogue.
Absolutely, I appreciate you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, do I hear a motion to open the floor to public comments?
So moved.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, as I reiterate, each speaker will have 3 minutes to make comments. If your comment's been made by a previous speaker, please do not replicate the comments. Direct them to the Board of Zoning Appeals. And not directly to the applicant. Once the floor has been closed to public comments, no additional comments can be made. What's just transpired is that we've had some real clarification on what the heck we're here for. So, you know, I like that. That's a good thing. So maybe some of those comments will go away, but nevertheless, anybody willing to speak in favor of the application, please approach the podium. I have a whole list of attendees here. What do I do with this? Could you please read it?
From Chris and Deborah Poulos at 6711 Oakfield Drive, Dayton, Ohio, 45415. Right to the City of Clayton BZA. Hello, this is in regard to the request for a conditional use variance for 8627-8629 North Main in Clayton, Ohio to be used as a halfway house. We are firmly opposed to any such variance being granted as it will diminish the surrounding neighborhoods and the community at large. Our community resources are already taxed with several group homes in the area and this will only exacerbate the problem. Furthermore, the owner of this property appears, per the affidavit, to not live in our community. thus they have no investment or responsibility to the surrounding stakeholders in this area. Lastly, after reviewing the submission, we find it lacking a level of professionalism, hand drawings, that would indicate a lack of seriousness in ensuring that this establishment would be a good addition to the community. Please consider the community at large when making the decision, because once you go down this path, it will be hard to stem the tide of others that want the same exception. Respectfully, Chris and Deborah Poulos.
Thank you, Ms. Snyder. Would anybody like to come up and address the board as in opposition to this case? Okay. Yes, sir, please.
Dave Rockwell. I live at 4851 Dawnwood Drive. We've been there for 46 years. Seen a lot of good things in that neighborhood. A couple of bad things, but got them squared away. But the worst thing we had was on Maynard Avenue. It was a halfway house there, which I don't know the nomenclature that well. Halfway house, group home, I'm not sure, but I believe I was told it was run by the URS, and it was a complete cluster. They fought out in the streets, foul language. You could hear them screaming over at our house. So they kind of broke that up finally, brought some older ladies in, and it was very quiet after that. But I'm strictly opposed to it. All the neighbors are. We've got a good group down there, so that's all I got to say.
Mr. Rockwell, I appreciate that. Did you have a kid in Little League?
Huh?
Did you have a kid in Little League years ago?
Yeah, oh yeah.
I think that's where I know you from.
Many, many years
ago. Too many years ago. Thank you, Mr. Rockwell. I appreciate that. Anybody else?
Maria Jordan, 8640 North Main Street, and I would just like to express that I definitely have concerns after hearing this application. It seems to me there were a lot of maybes, collaborations, and that sort of thing. I would much rather see some signed information, people that are taking an interest in this, maybe even coming to the meeting and expressing that they would be supportive of this. And can I ask you some questions regarding that?
If you can.
I am wondering is this a definite legal lease of the property, or is this a land contract as well?
This is a lease from the way I understand it and the way it's been presented to us. When I was talking about an affidavit earlier, mm-hmm. I was talking about, in there it says leasing, okay? And then we got into who the owner was, and that's why we had that big discussion about who the owner is, where they're at, and all that type of good stuff. So as far as we know, as far as it's been applied to us, it's a lease.
Yeah, and that would make you feel a little bit more comfortable, too, if maybe even the person that owns the property were here, that you could ask some questions of or address it to. And I was a little unclear on, like, the ages that might be in
that
this
wasn't
home.
Defined or touched on at this point.
Okay, and then they happened to mention that there would be peer support monitoring 24 hours. What does peer support monitoring?
Again, in the interest of time, I didn't want to get into the definition of some of the terms that were used,
mm-hmm.
but I think we have enough familiarization to at least get a feel for what those might be.
Yeah.
So that's why we left it there.
So, you know, those were just some of my concerns. And then they happened to mention it as a level 2. I don't know what that means.
Again, I know with certifications go at multiple levels. I come from a technical side, and when we go through CMMI level, you know, verification, there's level 1 through 5, okay? And those 1 through 5 defines the competency of the group that's being evaluated, starting with base procedures, working through evidence to indicate that the procedures are being followed, that there's continuous improvement, so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. And I assume, And again, this could be wrong, but I assume that that type of a level refers to that type of a, because I, again, I'm not familiar with the actual accreditation process, mm-hmm. nor have I read the book, but it makes sense that it would follow the same path.
Okay, and then it was also mentioned that in-house services would be provided. What does that refer to?
Again, if we had an operational handbook, we'd have that clarified.
Okay, and it was mentioned that there was an advisory board that was things were being discussed with, if you will. So what?
Again.
Does that okay? And then I'm just not comfortable with the assurances that I'm getting as how things will go. I feel like there needs to be a little bit more of that.
I understand your concern, and that's why we're here, is to help to ease those a little bit.
Yeah, and I appreciate that.
And I think the dialogue that we went through earlier really helped a lot.
Absolutely.
So thank you for your comments. Anybody else? Well, let's see. I'll ask for a motion then to close the floor to public comments.
I'll make a motion to close the floor.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Ms. Blanchard's. Would you like to address any of the comments that you've heard then since we've discussed?
Again, I thank everyone for their feedback, and I definitely hear your concerns, but what I would like to do is just to alleviate some of your concerns with respect to what a peer recovery specialist. That is someone that actually have went through a certification process may have had direct experience with substance use. However, has not only done a full recovery, but actually have gone through a certification process, educational process, in terms of actually being able to provide support to people that are actually currently going through that path of recovery. So it's not just someone that, you know, just, okay, I'm clean, I can help. This is someone that actually have gone through a significant process to actually be able to provide services. In terms of a level two, there's a level one, there's a level two, level three. For level one, there's actually no, there's just someone, they actually just live there, basically pay rent, and there's not necessarily any oversight. Well, for level two, there is a significant level of oversight in terms of staff at the property. That's why we wanted the level two versus a level one recovery house. With the level two recovery house, again, like I said, they would have case management, someone actually living on the property. We actually would have, again, surveillance. In terms of, when I say in-house, I'm talking about in-house in terms of actually, because if you see the property, there is a place where they actually be, where they the residents will actually reside, and there's another building where they actually will be receiving the services. So when I say in-house, that's what I was referring to.
Just one comment from me. I can't guarantee that they'll be quiet, but I can guarantee surveillance. I live there, so I don't like loud noise myself.
You need to talk it to them.
Oh,
please.
Sorry. I was saying I can't guarantee perfection, but I can guarantee I will definitely be surveilling because I don't like noise myself. I live right across there as well, so I can't guarantee total silence, but I'll try my best.
What I can guarantee is that there is curfew, and there is an expectation. We will not be, they will not be loitering in the front at all.
No company
after a certain time, and again, everyone will be
actively working.
Yes, actively working. Actively seeking it, or they're actually in a treatment program. Again, we'll be providing the transportation to and from wherever they need to go. There are certain things that are not allowed on the property because, again, this is a recovery house. I know you have people that are part of their recovery process. It's the MAT program, which is a methadone or a medication-assisted treatment. I recognize that it's a treatment. However, in terms of our property or where we can't accommodate people that are specifically that
need to utilize
in their recovery. Unless it's like an injectable and they're actually going to the facility again, but in terms of actually having it on our properties, that's not something that we can accommodate. So I just wanted to make that clear as to what.
Okay, you stated earlier that you're seeking some kind of state accreditation, right?
Yes.
You have
yes.
to get certified, be able to
yes.
open this house. And that's, what? How far along are you in the process there?
We're actually in the second stage of that. There's the completion of the application and the assignment for lack of a better term, a case manager to actually come out, view the property, let us know what if there's some additional things that we need to do in terms of making sure things are up to par, making sure our codes are that we're in compliance of everything, because otherwise we would have to go through them in order for OMAS to actually approve anything.
So we've already staged the property. We've already pretty much went through that whole process.
So they have a standards that you have to meet.
Absolutely.
And they list those pretty clearly to you. You have
yes.
to do these certain things to get accreditation. If you don't do this, you lose accreditation?
Yes.
And if you lose accreditation, you can't take clients.
That's absolutely.
So there are some safeguards there. If you said, you know, I'm hoping that
yes.
somebody said, If they don't do what they say they're going to do, you're going to lose your accreditation, right?
Yes.
And you couldn't function.
It's extensive.
Yeah, I'm a little familiar with that. So I just want to make that sure. To get that accreditation, you have to perform to their standards, meet their standards. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you lose accreditations, you're out of business.
Yep. Absolutely.
Okay.
Oh, it seems like you're kind of in a chicken and egg situation, because one of the things you need for the accreditation is this conditional use permit, but
yep.
one thing that would make us feel a lot better is knowing that you have the accreditation.
That's okay.
So could we possibly, and this would also maybe save the applicants more application fees, can we table this matter for 1 month until we get more details, the work plan, as much information as possible? What do you think, Mr. McGinnis?
Well, my comment about that is that would work if they were applying for a specific conditional use of what they're actually going to be using it for.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, they've applied for halfway house. And as a halfway house, ain't going to cut it.
I never applied for a halfway house.
Ma'am, I understand that. And again, I'm talking square pegs and round holes and all that kind of good stuff. And I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
However, bureaucratically, administratively, this is what we have in front of us. And I hesitate to rule positively on a halfway house because it's not going. It opens up the possibility that you will be getting people from courts, from the criminal justice system, because that I know that's not your intent, which is why I had the brainstorm of why don't we think about Premier? Why don't we think about some of these other and hook into those organizations? You may be really in trouble laying down the pike.
So how do we go about, because it kind of wouldn't be on our end as far as the conditional use part, that would be kind of on Clayton, to specify how we would go in that approach.
Again, I would talk with staff. I would talk
right.
with Ms. Snyder, say, is there any option along these lines? How can we proceed further? You know, and she's going to look at you and read all through, you know, all 490 pages of what our code is and say, I don't know, you know, and maybe she can, maybe she can't, you know. But nevertheless, a halfway house is not what, it's not what you want. I can tell you that right now. Maybe by going through additional avenues and maybe approaching Children's, Premier, or Kettering, you'd be able to get some really good ideas on how to do that there from them. Okay. Because they have the need. They've got the backlog, and you've got the off-ramp. Think about that.
It might require a little bit more investigation, because if we've determined that this is not a halfway house and the code doesn't mention sober living houses, it's possible that a conditional use permit might not be needed.
And that's what I've been told as well, but I still wanted to come forth and bring this to Clayton because, you know, I'm part of the community. I want to involve my community. So
absolutely,
just,
and
know.
Certainly we appreciate that. We appreciate your interest. We appreciate your involvement. We appreciate where you're going with this. You know, you're saying tomato, and everybody's hearing tomato, unfortunately.
Right.
And that could be a problem, so.
I think you guys are going to run a wonderful facility, whether it ends up being here or somewhere else, but the success of any facility like that is definitely going to be the buy-in of the neighborhood and the community.
Sure.
So if we take a little bit more time, get some more information out there, I think it would be for the better success of the project in the long run.
And one other thing I wanted to add, I'm willing to also have a community advisory board as well, because I think it's important in order for the community to be able to say, you know, have a say into as to what this, you know, is going to look like, because of course we need support, community buy-in, and to make sure that, you know, property values do not decrease. Mm-hmm. I get that. And make sure in terms of noise pollution that we're we're cognitive of that piece as well.
Exactly. That's perfect. Mm-hmm. In a lot of cases where there's a potential of a tricky community, you know, mm-hmm. conditional use or something like that being granted, that idea has been floated in the past. Mm-hmm. And it's the ones that are active are really good at it because, mm-hmm. you know, they do get that involvement. They do get that participation. They do get that feedback. And again, multiple people feeding back information to you mm-hmm. is a good thing.
Absolutely.
And then just to speak to Ms. Hunter, I actually had spoke with somebody. And I know it's ADA protected. So I know that they said that we may not need it after all. But I just, like I said, I just wanted to make sure that I was including, like I said, Clayton, and, you know, getting feedback. So that's why, you know, I'm absolutely grateful that we came because we just got a lot of feedback from you guys and we're able to kind of go do some more homework and, you know, get all our ducks in a row and have everything pretty much mapped out. And I still, of course, like to continue having a conversation with you guys and collaborating with you as well with that. So
that would be great.
Yeah.
You know, I know it'd be an extreme conflict of interest, but if I ever retired from this board, I'd be interested in being
okay,
in your
no,
advisory
absolutely.
Board.
No, absolutely.
Thank you all.
Okay. Well, thank you guys.
Ben,
have a good one.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
I still think there might be value in tabling it to aid their application with accreditation from the state. And then if, during the month that it's tabled, we discover that the application should be withdrawn entirely, then that happens and we just close it out.
Personally don't have a problem with that. That sounds fine to me. Do I hear a motion?
I move that we table this case for 1 month.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Roll call, please.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Ms. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it. We'll be in touch. And again, if you could work with staff, okay? But, you know, this is to adjust you and get you focused in properly, I think. Point of procedure, I guess. Can I ask for a recess for 10 minutes? People can have a drink of water. Or we don't have a court reporter here tonight, but what do you think? Five works for me.
Yeah.
We have three.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay, next one. Next case is VAR 2405, request for variance to section 1121.06, point C, point double I of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code, specifically requesting to be permitted to operate a drive-through facility between the hours of 12 a.m. and 5 a.m. at the property located at 7151 Hoke Road.
Good evening again.
Staff.
Introduction to application. Application number VAR 24-05 was received on August 14th, 2024. Request is for a variance to section 1121.06.C.1.II of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code. Request is for the operating hours of a drive-through. The applicant is Fiesta Holdings Incorporated, which is the intended property owner. A public notice was printed in the Eaton Register Herald on August 21st, 2024. Letters to property owners within 300 feet of the subject property were postmarked on August 16th, 2024. The subject property is 7151 Hoke Road, parcel M60032010045. The property has an area of 1.349 acres, and it is currently zoned CMX, or commercial mixed use. This is a map of the general location. The subject property is on the southwest corner there of Hoke and Salem, and then everything highlighted is within 300 feet of the subject property. This is a more specific location and an overhead view. This aerial is from 2022 when Burger King was still in operation. We know that Burger King is no longer in operation. And this is just another more specific location and why they're requesting a variance. The distance from the drive-through speaker that will remain is approximately 200 feet from the residential home and is approximately 110 feet from the property line. And we can see that that's an RSD zoning district and this property's in the CMX. Analysis of the request. The applicant desires to operate a drive-through between the hours of 12 a.m. and 5 a.m., more specifically from 12 a.m. to 4 a.m. daily. The requested variance is from section 112106C1II of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code, and that section says if within 200 feet of a district that allows single-family residential dwellings, drive-throughs may not operate between the hours of 12 a.m. and 5 a.m. The applicant indicates the purpose of the drive-through operating between the hours of 12 a.m. and 5 a.m. is to provide residents and businesses a late-night food option. The applicant indicates the operation of a drive-through as opposed to a walk-up window is a safer and quieter alternative. The applicant indicates they intend to comply with landscaping requirements, which will help mitigate the travel of noise generated by the drive-through. And also to note, the applicant indicates they intend to be responsive to any complaints received by adjacent residents. Here is their site plan. The applicable code section that addresses general regulations for properties in Clayton with a non-residential use is 1121.06. Section 1121.06.C.1.II regulates the operating hours of a drive-through if said drive-through is within 200 feet of a district that allows single-family residential dwellings. In addition, the board should refer to section 1141.07, which outlines the procedures for obtaining a dimensional or locational variance from the development standards in the Planning and Zoning Code. After evaluating the applicant's request, staff recommends the Board of Zoning Appeals approve the requested variance as submitted.
Thank you, Ms. Snyder. Questions for Ms. Snyder from the board?
Is Taco Bell's taking ownership of the property contingent on them being able to operate a drive-through until 4 a.m.?
That is not my understanding. It's my understanding that it's under contract. It just hasn't processed yet.
I remember the Burger King application. I drove through there just for grins, and you know, the signage that we were concerned about, you know, is pretty clear about not making a left turn out of the front, you know, to do a one-way, you know, front-end type of a crash on 70. I haven't seen any of that or heard of any of those type of incidents, which is good. When you exit the property, the signage is appropriate, directing traffic toward 70, 70 West, and 70 East. So I think that's good, too. I think the continued development of Hoke Road and 79 or State Route 49 intersection to support I-70 and increase traffic, it's just going to increase in the future. We've had discussions down there about hours of operation. The hours of operation as posted on Burger King was 24 hours a day on the drive-up window. I'm not sure if in the minutes of the meeting that we had that approved that conditional use, whether we limited the hours or not. I don't have a copy of it, but, you know, it may be something to look for, you know. However, I think True North right across the street is a 24-hour, seven-day-a-week operation, and I believe Wendy's closes at like 1 o'clock in the morning. So, you know, I would think that for a fast food restaurant, and I did notice, surprisingly enough, that there was an increase in activity at True North at like 1, 2 o'clock in the morning, of all things, you know. So maybe that would draw people in if Taco Bell was open. We were really pretty good on the screening and that type of good stuff. I'd be interested in hearing if that screening is sufficient to the immediate neighbor, you know, and from there, I personally, you know, I think it's a reasonable application.
I would agree.
Any more comments or questions to staff? No. Okay. Would somebody like to come up and talk about the application? Please, then, for us.
Thank you. Consider for the future, but just to address that first question. Essentially, you know, Taco Bell is known for late night food. We created the fourth meal, as we call it. And I gave Ms. Snyder just an example of how our sales come in during the day. So after midnight at our closest store in Trotwood on Salem, we do about 20% of our business. So it's a very large chunk of our business. And about 80% of that business is drive-through customers, people that want a convenient, quick, late-night option to get in and out really quick, stay in the comfort of the car, especially it gets cold here in the Midwest. So just stay in the car, get served in 3 to 4 minutes, be on their way, go back home. The other 20% is about delivery, digital sales. So it's a very large chunk of our business, a very important part of our business. We're not even open for breakfast. We're planning on opening around 9 o'clock in the morning. And then we generally, you know, say we're gonna start a store around 2 or 3 in the morning and maybe grow till 4 in the morning as our business grows. So we just wanted to kind of ask for the most that we think we could probably stay open until and shrink that if the business is not there late night.
Said you own several, your company owns several Taco Bells. You mentioned the one in Trotwood. Any other local ones?
Yeah, so this will be, we're working on two concurrently right now, one in City of New Carlisle and then this one here in Clayton. So those will be our 19th and 20th location in the Dayton metropolitan area. So we operate as far south as Centerville and all the way up to Bell Fountain, New Bremen. And we've opened 4 locations in the last 4 years in smaller communities, New Lebanon, New Bremen, Germantown, and done really well. And we've been very passionate about growing our business and finding smaller communities to do business in.
So the presentation, it said the applicant promises to be responsive to any issues from neighbors. Can you give an example of like something that's happened in the past and how you guys were able to resolve that?
Yeah, absolutely. It wasn't even actually something that needed to be resolved, but we kind of faced a little bit of opposition in our Germantown location, which we opened late last year. There were concerns around the light that was coming off the main pylon sign. After the presentation, after we reviewed the plans, the height of the building, and where the houses were located behind the sign, there was really no concerns, and City Council and Planning Board was totally okay with it. But there were concerns around like just pure light lumens coming off of the building and the pylon sign from residents. There didn't end up being any issues, but we offered, say, you know, if we need to put up landscaping, if we need to lower the signage, anything like that, we're totally open to that. I have had the opportunity, I've had my administrator reach out to the properties around us within 300 feet. I've also had the opportunity to connect with a couple residents, Mr. Bollinger, who I believe lives at 7078, and then Ms. Rodenberg, and she's the direct neighbor of this property. And definitely heard some concerns around some lights, specifically headlights for cars that are coming in, because I believe that she has some young children. I do as well, so I'm totally understanding of that concern, as well as late night noise that could be generated on the property, because my understanding is, and I don't hang out late night in Clayton, but my understanding is that the True North right across the street does attract some loud customers with car stereos or just talking late at night. So that was also, I think, one of the points that I wanted to try to clarify and put out there in the application, was that we believe that the drive-through is the quickest, quietest, most convenient option for customers to get in and out and get quickly on their way down Salem or Hoak or wherever, you know, whichever direction they're going.
And you're considering, or are you going to propose having it operating as drive-through only during those hours? Is that what I'm hearing too?
Correct, yeah. So the large majority of our stores typically close their dining room around 10 to 12, maybe midnight, and then they operate as drive-through only, because the business slows down a little bit once you hit midnight, and questionable things sometimes happen after midnight. So just from a safety and security standpoint, we felt like midnight is, for most of our stores, based on locations, based on crime statistics, things like that, is the safest time to close and lock the lobby and then go drive-through only. We do have some exceptions. One exception would be Brown Street, for instance, close to University of Dayton, large late-night business, and delivery drivers constantly there. We're right across the street from Miami Valley Hospital, so there's always people in and out and a very busy store. This store is just a little bit more isolated, so there's certain things that we look at in terms of the general trade area, and so we felt like closing the dining room at midnight and then operating drive-through would be the best way to serve the 80% of drive-through customers and then 20% or so of the delivery drivers that come through.
Okay. Thanks. I appreciate that. That makes sense. Ms. Snyder, I recall the Casey's drive-in that we have up there, you know, at the corner of Union Road and 49. And there was considerable discussion from the neighbors about headlights going in and out of Casey's, too. And I think Casey's is also a 24-hour operation. It'd be interesting to know whether there's any negative feedback still. I thought that was all alleviated by the type of screening that they put up. It wasn't live screening, like trees or, you know, foliage or anything along those lines. I think it was a fence that they then masked with evergreens or that type of, so, and I'm not sure what Burger King has in place there, but if there is a problem with neighbors specifically with headlights, then that might be an option to consider. I don't know.
Absolutely, yeah.
We'll hear what people have to say. But
yeah, and that's something that I can bring up to my brand designer at Taco Bell. Anything that's specific to this site, he can work with me to create solutions. One might be, there's currently the two drive-through stations that Burger King used to have. We're going down to one, so that landscape island could perhaps have some sort of artificial barrier that once the cars are making that turn and hitting Ms. Rodenberg's house with the path of the light, maybe we could dull it that way, completely block it. There's also, just based on the way that the parking lot slopes, it slopes down towards Salem and then down towards our neighbors, Ms. Rodenberg's house. So I believe she has a fence, 6-foot fence, but it's not high enough because based on the slope, so the way that the car headlights are angled, it's going straight into the house, even with blackout blinds. So that's something that we could definitely entertain, is either something directly in that landscape island to block when the cars make that turn and be able to do that later into the night, or else maybe something that goes directly along the curb at a higher elevation than the fence and then block any sort of light.
Those all sound possible. Yeah, those all sound good. And some of the headlights, of course, are these big LED ones that everybody has to squint at when they're coming at you, even though they're low power, allegedly. So, you know, I can appreciate that. Any other comments or questions to our applicant here? Hearing none, thank you. I appreciate that. Okay. We may have some more comments for a little bit later.
Sure. Yeah, thank you.
I'd like to open the floor to public input then. Roll call, please.
Move to open the floor for public input.
Second.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Is there anyone here that wished to speak in favor or? Okay, ma'am.
I am the aforementioned Mrs. Rodenberg. We are the house that you saw on the slide that lives directly behind my address. Sorry, 7101 Hoke Road, Clayton, Ohio. So to our understanding, that 6-foot fence was put in when Burger King went in, which was fine and dandy, I guess, for them, but it, as you said, the slope, it just doesn't work, and so another 2 to 4 feet is probably necessary to block out the light. We are in favor of the drive-through, though, over having people in the dining room overnight. Our main issue with noise coming from that Shell gas station is people just sitting there with their base or people racing down 49, but that's a different issue. So yeah, we are definitely for it. We would prefer that it was drive-through only if they're going to be operating in night hours. We do not really want the dining room open and people hanging out. So that's our feeling.
Appreciate your comment. Sounds to me like you have a willing participant there to work with you to try to make that work.
Yeah, and he's been very accommodating. I've spoken personally with him. He's provided his cell phone number. So as far as a businessman that's good for the community, I would say he seems to be.
Just to clarify, you're in favor of the variance?
Yes, I would prefer a drive-through than people hanging out. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate that.
Anybody else wish to speak in favor or against this particular application? Do I hear a motion to close the floor for public comments?
I make a motion.
Second? I'll second that. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay. Discussion among the board. Any comments, questions, clarifications for either staff or for the applicant? I think that'd probably be wise to at least it's addressed to the satisfaction of the neighbor and to the applicant. Hearing none then, I'll provide the findings of fact. Special conditions and circumstances exist which are peculiar to the land structure or building involved, which are not applicable to any of the land structure or building within the same zoning district. I do have an agreement here, but there are neighboring personal residences, and we've addressed that during our discussion of this particular case, and that will be addressed under section 7 when we get to it. So yes, for that one, a literal interpretation of the planning and zoning code would deprive the applicant of rights commonly enjoyed by other property owners in the same zoning district under the same provisions of the planning and zoning code. I agree, and again, I reference the 24-hour operation of True North, Casey's, which is down the road, Wendy's, which closes, I think, at 1 o'clock in the morning, so yeah, and with the potential expansion of I-70, that I can just see that type of activity increasing. Agreeing to having as a drive-through during the hours of operation in the early morning hours is again, a good thing, so the applicant has made that clear. So yes on number two. Number three, special conditions and circumstances do not result from the actions of the applicant. I would say yes, and again, I'm looking at the future development of Hoke Road and the State Route 49 interchange to support I-70 traffic. It should increase in the future. So I can see that traffic and demand for services increasing in that area. And Hoke Road and 49 is a large interchange, and it's zoned pretty much commercial, I believe, all the way down 49. And I can see where development would be coming in the future, too. Number four, granting the variance requested will provide the minimum necessary relief to alleviate the practical difficulties the applicant is experiencing. Again, it's. I think that this application is just for the operation at night, but it's consistent with the True North and Wendy's hours of operation, and it's already gone through this board under the previous owner, which was Burger King. So, you know, we've addressed a lot of the issues already just with the use itself. Granting the variance will be in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the planning and zoning code, will not cause damage or harm to the neighborhood or otherwise be detrimental to public health, safety, and welfare. Again, we addressed that with item two and item three. And also with the traffic pattern, the signs are still in place. The applicant has mentioned that maintenance will be done on the property, which will reduce the weeds, so that'll increase the sight lines. We do know, and I'm sure the applicant knows, that with the JVS and the Caterpillar building down the road, there's an increase in traffic at specific times of the day. However, the applicant is looking for only an extension of the operating hours to 4 in the morning, 3 in the morning, 5 in the morning? 5, 4, okay. Item 6, the proposed variance will not constitute a change in zoning district, including variation in use on the official zoning map. In no case shall the board approve a variance for a use which is not a permitted use in the zoning district in which the land structure or building is located. I agree with that. And other relevant factors which may assist the board in weighing and balancing the public and private benefits and harms to determine if the requested relief is necessary, with the exception that no non-conforming use of neighboring land structures or buildings in the same zoning district, no permitted non-conforming use of land structures or buildings in any other zoning district shall be considered justification for approval of the requested variance. And I agree with what we have here is good. So based on the above, I would think that we might hear a motion with the addendum at the end that Ms. Hunter had referenced. So do I hear a motion?
I move that we approve variance 24-05 with the condition that the applicant work with the neighbors to have a suitably high fence to block headlights.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, it's been approved. So good luck. Good luck. Safe sleepless nights. No.
But you won't have to go far for a good taco.
That's right. All right. Well, shall we forward ahead? Okay. Next case is VAR 24-06, a request for variance to section 1111.11.E.F of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code, specifically requesting to be permitted to construct an accessory structure less than 5 feet from recorded easement and taller than 15 feet at the property located at 6811 Ramsey Place.
The application number VAR 24-06 was received on August 13th, 2024. The request is for a variance to section 1111.11.E.F of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code. The request is for the location and height of an accessory structure. The applicant is Elena M. Walker, who is also the property owner. Public notice was printed in the Eaton Registered Herald on August 21st, 2024. Letters to property owners within 300 feet of the subject property were postmarked on August 16th, 2024. The subject property is 6811 Ramsey Place, parcel M602851800027. The property has an area of 0.316 acres and is currently zoned RSD, or Residential Single Unit District. This is a map of the general location. Everything highlighted is within 300 feet of the subject property. This is a more specific location of the subject property. Analysis of the request. The applicant desires to construct an accessory dwelling unit less than 5 feet from a recorded easement, but not within the recorded easement. The applicant desires to construct an accessory structure more than 15 feet in height. The requested variance is from section 1111.11.E.F of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code, which states accessory building location, rear yard 5 feet from any lot or recorded easement, no closer to the front lot line than 10 feet behind the front building line, accessory building height, maximum 15 feet. The applicant indicates the purpose of the accessory dwelling unit is for her son to use and enjoy. The applicant indicates her son, due to medical reasons and diagnosis, is not otherwise able to enjoy the freedoms and enjoyments that would be granted to him under different circumstances. The applicant indicates they intend to comply with all other requirements of accessory dwelling units provided in section 1121.02.B, which addresses standards for accessory dwelling units. This is the site plan submitted by the applicant. We can see here that the accessory dwelling unit, it's a little bit difficult to see, but is at least 5 feet from the side property line and 8 feet from the house, but is about less than a foot, I would say, from the 50-foot easement that exists in the rear yard. The applicable code section that addresses the RSD zoning classification is 1111.11. Section 1111.11.E.F regulates the location and height of accessory structures within the RSD zoning classification. The applicable code section that addresses general regulations for properties in Clayton with a residential use is 1121.02. Section 1121.02.B regulates the standards for accessory dwelling units in any district where permitted. In addition, the board should refer to section 1141.07, which outlines the procedures for obtaining a dimensional or locational variance from the development standards in the Planning and Zoning Code. After evaluating the applicant's request, staff recommends the Board of Zoning Appeals approve the requested variance as submitted.
Questions from the board for staff? That's quite a setback in that backyard.
It is. It's a 50-foot utility easement. It's my understanding that there is some higher power lines over top that kind of span out a little bit.
Thank you. That helps. Now, in the definition, our accessory buildings, this unit that's being recommended is otherwise known as a mother-in-law suite, right?
Yes.
Okay, and there is leeway about whether it should be detached or could be attached to the house, you know, specific to the design.
Yeah, the applicant has the option to either have it attached or detached, whichever they prefer. And then if it is detached, they have to comply with all the regulations listed in that section of code.
I recall another case in the past where somebody came in and applied for this, and they were going to turn it into a pole barn because they were working on their primary resident and having that, you know, construct at the same time. So, yeah, I was kind of flipped at that when I first looked at this, and I said, oh, no, wait a minute, this, no, it's a mother-in-law suite. And we have had that applications in the past that we've approved as well. So I just wanted to clarify that we're not setting any precedent here or anything along those lines. So, yeah.
Nope.
We're good. Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Any other questions for staff here? Have you seen the plans?
Yeah, plans are included as part of the site plans. I wasn't able to include them in the presentation, unfortunately, but they are in your packets and they are on our website for review.
Okay, and the actual square footage is it's 864 square feet or less?
Yes.
How's the 15 feet deal with the top of the primary residence?
I don't know the height of the primary residence.
Well, we can ask the applicant that. Okay. I don't have any other questions. Does anybody else? Okay. Thank you. Appreciate that. Is the applicant here? Ma'am. Again, please state your name and your address.
My name is Elena Walker, and I'm the property owner at 6811 Ramsey Place.
Welcome. Based on what you've heard with the presentation, is there anything you'd like to add? Any other comments you'd like to make?
The only thing I think I left out was just how the tiny home would be facing. It would be facing the south side, so the interior of our backyard.
So it'll be facing your backyard?
Correct.
Okay.
South side.
And then if I... plan that was put up...
Say it again.
Is that a tree line that's going to be...
No, it wouldn't be a tree line. It would just be the interior of our yard. So if I'm facing the front of our yard, it would be on the right side, and then it would be facing the interior of our yard. We have maybe a couple trees kind of along the perimeter of our neighboring bordering neighbor's yard, and then we have a tree line for the setback, the 50 feet further back. So there's no trees. There are trees there now where the property would, where the tiny house would go, but those have to be removed, and there's just two trees that are in our yard.
And how tall is your residence?
I don't know the exact height, but our residence would be taller than the tiny home. It's a two-story.
Placement's going to be behind the front building line.
Oh, yes, yes.
Because it's in the backyard.
Yep.
Okay. Do you have any septic back there or anything, or any utilities that are buried?
Not back there, because everything runs out to the curb, basically the street.
Okay.
They would be buried, and we'd have to tap into those lines.
Okay, so the construction of the accessory unit will have to tap in then to the existing plumbing.
Correct.
Utilities, electrical. Water, all that kind of good stuff. Okay. Thank you. Any questions from the board for Ms. Walker?
A attack.
don't have a whole lot of room. We discussed maybe doing like a garage, redoing the garage to a separate unit, but cost-wise, that might be a little bit more effective, but we really wanted a separate area for my son. That's been his goal and dream, to have his own place, per se. I'd also mention the application is we have a lot of staff that helps us out, nurses at night, direct support specialists in the Department of Disabilities, so we have a lot of people in the house, and it's hard to have, to be comfortable in your own home when you have a lot of people coming through at all hours and things like that, so it's just easier to kind of separate the two and have that separate space as well. And we also have another son, too, so he likes to engage with staff, which makes it hard to get true respite or get, you know, separate time, I guess, if you will.
Have you considered a separate entrance on the outside, though, so that anybody that needed to come in there could use that separate entrance rather than go through your house?
Well, we have multiple doors on our first level, which is nice. So in our house in the back, we have a back patio, like a paver's patio on the left side of our house. They could go out that way and across. We also have one on the back side of our living room, which is just over from the pavers. There's a door there as well. And then on the side of our house for our laundry room, we have another additional door. So we could even make a walkway from that door if we wanted to, but there's multiple entryways to get out and get in.
Can you describe your backyard? Is there any hill associated with that, or any topography that we need to be concerned about?
The only issue would be there is a bit of a slope, and it's really pretty much at that 50-foot setback line. So it's more, I mean, we couldn't build there anyways behind that line. So for us, the only place to really build is on the side there. That's the only suitable area in our yard, and also to keep some yard space available.
Okay, so you don't have to worry about, you know, building on a slope, but
no,
you're going to be building out to the slope.
Yeah, the only thing is we have to take out some trees there, just two trees.
Our variance is talking about the lot line. If there's a way to restructure, then maybe we can do away with even having to have a variance, I think is where you're fishing at.
Well, it's a variance for height and a variance for position.
So it's a variance for both. Questions for the applicant? Thank you, Ms. Walker. Appreciate that.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I'd like to open the floor to public comments then. Roll call, please.
Motion we have before.
That's second.
Mr. McGinnis?
Aye.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
You'd think I'd know that by now, wouldn't you, Barb? Good grief. Okay. Same rules that we talked about for the conditional use. Is there any public comment in favor or against the application? Did we get any emails or communications that staff would like to read or indicate, please?
So we received three letters. I don't know if any of the individuals are here tonight. We received the first letter from Seth Paulus and Amula Raguvir, 6830 Ramsey Place, Dayton, Ohio, 45415. Dear City of Clayton Board of Zoning Appeals members, we received a notification on 8/15/2022 related to a request of variance for a new structure to be built as an independent dwelling at 6811 Ramsey Place. We are vehemently opposed to this rezoning petition and protest the approval of the construction of this accessory structure for the following reasons. The independent dwelling would have a significant impact on the remaining five properties on Ramsey Place. A smaller apartment-sized dwelling behind a full-sized house is inconsistent with anything in the current plat in addition to all other surrounding plats. The current staked property appears to measure approximately 850 square feet, which is consistent with a small prefabricated dwelling that may contrast with existing building codes. The property markers appear to be staked for water and electricity, and this appears unsafe when factoring in proximity to the existing dwelling, the proximity to the swale, which consistently rises when flooded right to the staked property, and the surrounding woods area by the swale. The proposal for this unit appears to align with the Airbnb movement that is occurring in other cities, with individuals building micro houses in their respective backyards to rent out, which brings with it an entirely new set of challenges. Finally, the stake property appears to be extremely close to the existing home, which raises the question of why not request an addition that is connected to the existing dwelling. Finally, while not perhaps as salient as an issue, the current property owners appear to be consistently challenged with maintaining their existing property, and the current neighbors at 6821 Ramsey Place, who are a lovely elderly couple, consistently complain about this as the lack of maintenance on the property at 6811 Ramsey Place routinely encroach on the property at 6821 Ramsey Place, causing consternation for many of us on Ramsey Place. Please note, this is not personal, as we do not have any challenges with the property owners at 6811 Ramsey Place. We are concerned about property valuations with a small micro house right behind an existing house, proximity to the swale, actual intent of use of the new micro house, and the hazards that may arise with this micro house, factoring in safety, access to fire hydrants, and future use with respect to Airbnb concerns. We are requesting a rejection of the variance to the section for this construction and denial of permit to build this standalone structure. Sincerely, Seth Paulus and Amula Raghuveer. The next one is from Robert M. Pamela Stout at 6821 Ramsey Place. And they say, first of all, I want to thank the City of Clayton for communicating with my wife and I, and other surrounding neighbors regarding this subject matter. We also value the opportunity you have extended to us for feedback on the issue. This is a difficult letter for us to write. In our 55 years of marriage, we have never filed a letter of protest or had any reason to formally object a debate, an issue such as this. We love our home, our neighbors, our surroundings, and the Clayton neighborhoods we have lived in for the past 35 years. When we purchased our home at 6821 Ramsey Place, referenced affected parcel M602851800026, it is with the stipulation that the Rundell Estates development was constructed and designated as single family dwellings on each assigned lot. This was an extremely important feature and expectation we had for our home purchase. To have multiple dwellings constructed on a given lot would be synonymous to an apartment complex. This was not the plan or expectation homeowners had then or currently desires now. Our major concern is that the current owners of the subject property or future owners might elect to lease the property, the proposed accessory structure, and convert it to a rental residence. In our opinion, this opportunity would be very disturbing because of the potential rapid turnover of rental inhabitants, additional stress on street parking space in the adjacent Ramsey Place cul-de-sac area, and as stated above, the deviation from a single family structure to multiple structures on the property. We are surprised and disappointed that the Clayton Development Department entertained such a plan to construct an accessory dwelling unit less than 5 feet from a recorded easement and taller than 15 feet at the subject existing property. Essentially, the willingness to deviate from existing building and zoning code at the expense of surrounding homeowners. Our property value is an important aspect and financial investment we have undertaken as a homeowner. The subject proposed request for variance does not offer any consideration for likely negative outcomes for the surrounding homeowners. As a result, we strongly feel that the Clayton Development Department should have a firm commitment to uphold the prescribed building and zoning codes for our neighborhood, for the protection and welfare of the Clayton homeowners and protection from resultant declining property values. In summary, we understand and are sensitive to the needs of our neighbor and their son, Sebastian. However, we are also sensitive to the negative and financial burden the proposed design approach, i.e. building an accessory structure behind the primary structure, will place on area homeowners. We are hopeful an alternative approach to the request for a variance to section 1111.11.E.F of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code at the property located at 6811 Ramsey Place is considered to satisfy, and meet the needs of all parties affected by this subject request for zoning change. It is difficult to understand why an addition to the existing primary structure with applicable design features to meet the needs of the family isn't considered. In conclusion, we are strongly opposed to the subject request for variance to the existing zoning codes for the reasons cited above. Best regards, Robert and Pamela Stout. And the third one that was received is from Debbie Hustleman. It's Thomas and Deborah Hustleman, 6820 Ramsey Place. And they say, we appreciate the city letting us voice our opinion regarding this situation. We live in a nice, quiet residential neighborhood within the city. All houses are single family homes. Some homes have sheds. A typical shed might be 8x10. Some properties have 6-foot privacy fences, whether it be for safety around pools or just privacy. Even a 6-foot fence will not hide a 15-foot structure. There are no additional structures 15 feet or taller in our area. They don't have electricity or plumbing, which we're assuming are part of the plan for this structure. A separate structure 15 feet or taller does not go with our neighborhood. We are not in the country where you have more room and neighbors are not always close to you. Our homes are close in proximity. Their plan might be for their son to live in the structure, but do not know future plans with future neighbors. Where this structure is planned would make me uncomfortable if it was to the rear of my property. 15 feet high would block view around the area and change the look of our neighborhood. We are opposed to the petition as it stands now. We are asking you to deny permission for this planned structure. We might be in agreement with an addition to the house itself. A mother-in-law suite is an addition to a home and probably isn't 15 feet tall and blends into a house and neighborhood. Thank you for your consideration. Respectfully, Thomas and Deborah Hustleman. That's everything that I received.
Thank you very much. Anybody in the audience wishing to speak in favor of this application? Anybody in the audience wishing to speak opposed to this application? Okay, having nobody coming up here. Do I hear a motion to close the floor to public comments?
Move to close the floor for public comments.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Ms. Walker, could you come up again? And if you could, please give your thoughts about the comments that we did receive through email, please.
Sure. So one of the comments was the view, obstructing view. I'm not sure exactly how that would happen right now where the tiny house would be. The adjacent neighbor, they actually have tall, I don't sure what they're called, but they're cone-shaped like arborvitae bushes that are probably at least 13, 14 feet high. And they have some other lower shrubbery. Their lot is a corner lot. I don't know if you can pull it up, but it's a corner lot, so it does not face our home. It's a triangle. We're off to the side, so their view is back, and then they would have to be off to the side for them to actually, I guess, have their view obstructed by looking out the side of their home. Correct. So if you can see, there's those bushes there, kind of that curved view there between the houses. So that's already obstructing their view, if you will. And then there's two trees where the tiny home will be in that corner. So there's trees already there. So there's not much of a view.
On that picture, mm-hmm. could you point specifically to where the proposed structure is going to be? I didn't bring my laser pointer, and I apologize. It's lot 27? Gotcha. Okay.
Porch and patio that's enclosed, so that's kind of already obstructing their view there. They can't really see past, and I assume they put it up for privacy.
Gotcha. It is the porch that's under discussion on the next property toward the ceiling? Okay, and can you describe if that is a porch at the end of their house?
Yeah, thank you. It's like a covered porch. If it can reach.
Gotcha.
Right up there, gotcha. Right top of the structure. So, yeah. But
yeah, honestly, that might be irritating. You know, I appreciate your wish to have a separate home. I'm wondering what your thoughts are about thinking about the design of it again. When we read your application, sense of space, you know, all this, get it, I understand. But if you could think about that a little bit, do you have any thoughts about that, about the height? And, you know, I can see where that neighbor might get irritated with the placement of it right outside that porch.
Well, like I said, the porch is not facing that way. Their porch is facing the back corner of the lot. So, I mean, it would be looking off to the side, I guess, from the windows in the porch up there. Because this is all building brick, and there's even any windows right here on this side.
So there are no windows right there.
No windows right here.
Okay, so it is facing away from you, away from your property.
The triangle for their lot.
And the whole neighborhood's filled with ranch homes, is that correct?
No, we're actually one of the few, like there's two-story homes, there's tri-level homes, and then there's ranch, so it's a mix. But our home, I think, is probably the most different. We had an architect build our house, not personally, but prior to, and they designed it how they wanted it.
Okay. Any other?
No car access to the new structure? Would it just be like a footpath?
Doesn't need to be any car access. I mean, we have a two-car garage, and then we have enough for four cars in our driveway. So he doesn't drive, but we have room for like our ancillary staff and things like that to park in the driveway if need be.
The current design is 2 feet higher than is allowed by code.
Roughly, yes.
So was there any way to keep the structure 15 feet or under?
We could potentially make it a little bit shorter, yes, to the 15 feet.
Okay. Then you wouldn't need the variance for height, which would be a relief. And the position variance seems reasonable because of that giant easement
yes.
in the backyard that you can't
use.
We
wanted it originally further back, but can't do anything for that. So, yeah, we'd be willing to consider the shorter structure to meet that variance or meet that code.
I'm sorry, that should have been on the record. ADUs are permitted uses,
right.
So you know that's not a problem. What we're looking at is we're looking at the placement,
mm-hmm.
the setback, and if you are willing to reduce the height of it by 2 feet, then we can modify the variance, I believe, to just strike out that provision. Is what we're talking about.
Okay.
Is that acceptable?
I believe so, yes.
And I also just feel the need to, although we're sympathetic to the concerns about future Airbnbs, Airbnbs are not permitted in
exactly.
this type of neighborhood.
Or even rentals, from what I understand. Is that correct? Even rentals. That's not even an option anyway, so, and that's never our intention. So it's not like it could be future rented out to someone or a college student or something like
if
that.
If somebody in the future were to do that, they would be in violation of many different
right.
things.
I understood they had to be a family member or, okay.
That's absolutely true. I mean, we've heard that a couple times tonight, so, yeah. Okay, any other questions, any other comments to the applicant? Ms. Walker.
Thank you.
Thank you, we appreciate your patience.
Thank you.
Do I hear a motion? Findings of fact, who was? With the condition of the height will be less than 15 feet, well, will be 15 feet
or less
for the structure. Yeah. Okay, we have a motion on the table. Do we hear a second?
I'll second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter? Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Thank you, Ms. Walker. Appreciate that. If you could work with her just to make sure that, you know, your plans are adjusted appropriately, and I think we're in good shape. And because I think you got to have a building permit anyway to get the thing started. So, okay.
All right.
Thank you very much. Gee, I wanted a break. Well, silly me. Okay. The last case in front of us is VAR 24-7, a request for a variance to section 1111.13 and 1121.06.B of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code, specifically requesting to be permitted to construct a primary structure more than 60 feet from the front property boundaries with a front yard parking that will be served by a loading facility in the front yard less than 145 feet from the center line of the road and within 100 feet of a district that allows residential use at a property located at M60 03207-0020.
Application number VAR 24-07 was received on August 16th, 2024. The request is for a variance to section 1111.13 and 1121.06.B of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code. The request is for the location of a primary structure, parking location, and loading area. The applicant is A4 Real Estate Group, LLC, which is the intended property owner, and public notice was printed in the Eaton Register Herald on August 21st, 2024. Letters to property owners within 300 feet of the subject property were postmarked on August 16th, 2024. The subject property is the southwest corner of Salem Avenue and Union Road, parcel M60032070020. I have a note here that they intend to split the parcel, and an area of 2.599 acres exists today, but the intended area is 1.3411 acres. It is currently zoned CMX, or commercial mixed use. This is a map of the general location. Again, this subject property is on the southwest corner here of Union and Salem Avenue. Everything highlighted is within 300 feet of the subject property. Here is a more specific location and what the topography looks like today. Go ahead.
If you can go back. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're looking at the blank parcel to the left center, correct?
It is the highlighted parcel, so it's got this teal outline on it.
Yes, the yellow line. Okay, so UDF is across the street, kitty corner, to the northeast, and Union Road then is running north-south, and then 49 is going, and we have a residence right next to that, and I believe we have a commercial hauler or a commercial distribution center continuing up 49, is that correct?
To the north of this is Casey's, and then to the right. Southeast of this location is the Roadstar Trucking.
That's right, okay, thank you.
The applicant desires to construct a Dollar General grocery store more than 60 feet from the proposed property boundaries. I meant to put front in there, my apologies. The applicant desires to designate parking in the front of the proposed business. The applicant desires to designate the loading area in the front of the proposed business less than 145 feet from the center line of the road and less than 100 feet from a district that allows residential uses. The requested variance is from section 1111.13 and 1121.06.B of the Clayton Planning and Zoning Code. Section 1111.13.E designates parking locations for side yard and rear yard. Section 1121.06.B.1.I.B designates loading areas must be located to the side or the rear of the building and may not be placed between the street and the building or any front facade of a building. Section 1121.06.B.1.I.G designates, with the exception of properties within the MSD, loading areas are not permitted within 100 feet of a district that allows residential uses. And finally, section 1121.06.B.1.II.B for over the road tractor trailers 12 feet 6 inches in width by 60 feet in length with a 70 foot maneuvering apron and shall have a vertical clearance of at least 15 feet. In no case shall the loading berth be less than 145 feet from the center line of the street. The applicant indicates the purpose of the structure is for food sales, large grocery use. This will be a grocery store Dollar General. The applicant indicates they intend to dedicate the existing right-of-way at the proposed location. The applicant indicates they intend to split the existing parcel into two separate pieces and then intend to purchase one of the pieces for the construction of the structure. The applicant indicates they intend to comply with all other requirements of the CMX zoning district, loading facilities, and generally applicable regulations of the planning and coding, planning and zoning code, excuse me. This is their initial site plan. This is for the dedication of right-of-way. So this is the parcel as it stands today, and then they'll dedicate the shaded portion that's already within the existing right-of-way. This is the next step in their plan, is to do a minor subdivision, which would split the parcel. And so they intend to buy the parcel to the right. And then finally, this is what they're proposing and what the requested variances are for. And this is just where the structure will be situated on that property after the minor subdivision. And then the proposed loading area is kind of down and to the right. It's approximately 25 feet from the property line and approximately 80 feet from the nearest home. The applicable code section that addresses the CMX zoning classification is 1111.13. Section 1111.13.E.G regulates the location of parking within the CMX zoning classification. The applicable code section that addresses general regulations for properties in Clayton with a non-residential use is 1121.06. And section 1121.06.B regulates the standards for loading facilities in any district where permitted. In addition, the board should refer to section 1141.07, which outlines the procedures for obtaining a dimensional or locational variance from the development standards in the planning and zoning code. After evaluating the applicant's requests, staff recommends the Board of Zoning Appeals approve the requested variance as submitted.
Questions for staff?
I guess when the letters went out, the neighbors became aware that there was going to be a Dollar General here, and general consensus is we don't want a Dollar General there when there's an empty like shopping complex just across the street behind UDF. Can you speak to why we are constructing a new building when there are so many unused buildings nearby?
This is the application that was received by staff.
Of the Dollar General. Has that already, at what point do the residents get to have input into that decision?
I haven't received any public input from letters or, emails or anything like that. There could be people here to speak this evening, but I haven't heard anything ahead of the meeting as far as public input. The Dollar General store could reconfigure the property, and then we would approve it administratively. But they are wanting to have this specific layout for the facility.
So procedurally, if we say no tonight, they will just put the loading dock somewhere else and it's still going to be a Dollar General?
They would have the option to, yes.
What's the purpose of splitting it? And what are they going to do? They're not buying all of it, they're just buying part of it?
Correct. It is my understanding that the owners of the property are the ones who own the billboard that's there, and they're not interested in being associated or having anything to do with the construction of a commercial facility there, and so they're willing to sell part of their property to a business.
That whole area is zoned commercial, right?
Yes, that is correct.
How far down Union Road does that commercial extend, or is this property the extent of the commercial zoning?
The Roadstar Trucking is to the southeast of this location, and that is CMI.
Most Dollar Generals that I've been in have had some food, but not really classified as a grocery. What's the definition of that, and what kind of percentage is? I'm kind of confused when I read that it was a grocery. Can you define that, please, for me?
Yeah, so grocery stores within our code are defined as somebody who has produce within a visible range of the entrance of the location and then have a certain percentage of their square footage designated for produce. They've indicated to us that this would be a grocery store, so we would ask them to comply with all those regulations as set forth within our code.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. Have they provided a lighting plan and all the other accoutrements?
No, but they have also not asked for a variance from any of those stipulations, so we would not deviate from the code.
Dollar General's been in the news a lot. You know, well, we're going to close 800 stores. Now we're going to, you know, open up 1,000 more. And apparently Ohio's like the third most populous of Dollar Generals. So, you know, there's been a lot of activity with the institution. Is this part of a concerted effort of Dollar General during this adjustment period that they're going through? Do you know, or had a conversation along those lines?
It's my understanding that the operational process for Dollar Generals is that a company comes in, buys the land, constructs the building, and then an owner of the Dollar General comes in and operates the facility, so they're all independently owned. So I can't speak to whether this is an effort, you know, for Dollar General in mass in our area.
Has our traffic department, of City Clayton Traffic Department, been alerted to this, and do they have any concerns or comments about ingress and, you know, the amount of traffic that this may generate? I know Union Road is getting busier and busier. I don't know what the city's plans are when it comes to Union Road and any future improvements, but I do know that there was considerable discussion with when Casey's went in, and so forth and so on. Now there's more houses being developed on the Westbrook side of that plat. Now I'm kind of a little bit concerned about how that volume is going to be handled, especially at that interchange.
Correct. Staff has already asked them to do a traffic study, and they are compliant with that.
So, and is the traffic study complete?
It is not complete at this point, no.
Okay. Do they have any projected traffic? How many cars is going to generate to go in and out of there? Do you know? Are you aware?
They've given
that?
Us a couple figures. I can't recall exactly how many, but they have made. They've given us figures for other stores with similar demographics to ours.
Where's the nearest Dollar General to this Dollar General? Are you within
the city of Clayton? It would be the one on Main Street.
Okay, that's what I was thinking. I thought there was one over there. Okay. Now we're talking about loading and unloading and that type of good stuff. When typically do they do that?
I don't know. I do know that there is a stipulation within the loading facilities that they cannot operate before the hours of 5 a.m. or after 12 a.m. So it's similar to the drive-through facility.
Okay. That makes sense. I think that's consistent with the area around the UDF where we've had discussions about, and Casey's as well. So that would be consistent to try to keep that down to a minimum when it comes to hours of operation. Are they going to be having normal hours of operation, though, like 9 to 5 or 9 to 9 or something along those lines?
My understanding is yes.
So they're not going to be 24-hour?
No.
Well, I got one more, I guess. Dollar Generals typically have a lot of lighting, and they have a lot of big parking lot area and that kind of good stuff. We're not sitting here as a planning board, but nevertheless, has consideration or thought been along those lines about how they're going to be illuminated and what's going to happen to the runoff that comes from water that, you know, falls on their parking lot as rain, so forth and so on?
So we do have stormwater management within our code, and we also have lighting provisions within our code, and we will not deviate from our code.
Okay, fair enough. Thanks. Had to ask. Okay, that sounds good. Any other questions for staff? Okay,
Thank you very much. Is there an applicant here that wishes to discuss this application? Sir, please.
Thank you. My name is Josh Allen with A4 Real Estate Group. I appreciate your time tonight and consideration of my requests for variances. I appreciate staff's review of the application. I did prepare a couple other slides. I don't know if you have any. Okay. Just to help further give context to surrounding properties and then also kind of what we're planning on doing. On the screen right here, you'll see an image of the CMX zoning area in which it kind of encompasses right around the site, and then an outline of the proposed site, you know, generally speaking on a colored map like this. So we are basically at the middle of this intersection zoning for the CMX district, very similar to how UDF is directly across the street and then Casey's as well. We're kind of mimicking that corner feel for the commercial little node of the area. If you want to hit a next slide on this one. This is, again, our proposed layout. In red there, you can kind of see there's a line that indicates where that front setback per the code would be required. So the building would be pushed up and over closer to the intersection. The reason for the request and the reason for the number of variances that we're talking about tonight is really specific to the nature of this corner parcel. And then also paying special attention to some other outside factors around the property and how we design to minimize any kind of impact. So specifically, there's residential there to the south. And then, you know, there's a major intersection sort of to the north of the corner of the property as well. So what we're trying to do is be very cognizant of both of those things, as that's probably the biggest elements to this property. If we would follow the code, we would have to move the building forward, which thus then puts all the parking behind, which then puts the parking directly next to the residential area, which obviously is not good for anyone. It's not great for shoppers. It's not great for the neighbors. And then along that same line, the only place to access this site is where we have it right now, and we've worked it out with Public Works as well, and they agree that that's the best place to access this property. Because we're the furthest away from the intersection as physically possible on this piece of land. If, again, we would comply directly by code without these variances, the building would be pushed further north, that entrance would remain where it is, and then the parking lot would be kind of down where the triangle part is on the site plan, which is what we're showing as currently as detention. And then the access to any remaining land that the property owner would like to keep would have to drive basically along the southern part of that property directly against the residential land. So we didn't think that was a good layout just in general for the piece of property. And then for an operations standpoint, it keeps the customers at the front door and then up on the road for as much visibility and security as possible. When you start tucking parking back behind buildings, it becomes sort of dead space, dark space that you don't really can't control that well. And then along the same lines, as you know, special attention's been thought of and made for lighting, specifically vehicular lighting. As you'll see, as you come and go from that entrance, all the vehicles will be parking either up against the building or facing up into the road. So again, minimizing the light spillover into the southern part of the property. So there has been a lot of specific thought about why it's laid out like this as it directly impacts the neighbors. As far as loading goes, with the location of that entrance, the loading is very difficult to put in the area in which the code would require. It would be back behind the building because this property technically has two frontages. Both roads are the front. And so in order to go by code, the loading area would be behind the building, essentially where that triangle is again, and nearest the residential property. So we're trying to keep that as far away as possible while still maintaining another part of the code that allows for vehicular circulation around the loading as well. So there's a lot of different design elements that we're trying to put into play here, as well as keeping all the adjacent properties in mind. So that's the layout. If you go to the next couple slides, this just shows sort of the precedent of the setbacks and the variances that I'm asking for tonight that are already existing in the community. So UDF has all the parking in the front, or actually it says 83% of their parking is in the front. Their setback is greater than the 60 as well. They have 92 on the one road and 125 on the other. The newly built Casey's is an 80-foot setback from Union, 145 from 49, and then all of their parking is in the front of the building, as well as their dumpsters and everything else. So we're trying to kind of keep that in mind as well as how we're designing it, that sort of fits the neighborhood as well. If you go to the next slide, it shows some other properties that are in the same zoning district, just a little further away from the property. The furniture store, which is the one on the left, 120-foot setback with 60% of their parking in the front. And that's very similar to kind of a layout that we're proposing today. And then the other place, which I believe is like a barbecue place, has all of their parking technically in their front yards too, because they're on a corner. So being a corner property really makes it difficult to make all of these work. So those are just examples in my presentation I wanted to have everyone have consideration of when making their decisions tonight. So I appreciate your time and your consideration. Here for any questions.
Appreciate your presentation. Any questions from the board?
Entrance to the store, is that on the north side or is it on the facing Union Road side?
No, so it would be facing up on the plan north, technically like northeast. Yeah, right on the 49. And that's where the sign will be too. The sign for the property will be up on the corner.
So your company is going to buy the land and build the Dollar General, and then another person is going to run the Dollar General?
No, it's a little bit different than how staff presented it, but you're right on the first part. So I'll buy the land, I'll build it, they lease it, and they run the business. So, yeah.
And have you already identified the lessee who's going to run the business?
Yeah, it's Dollar General Corporate. Yep, they run it all. They run every store.
Own the real estate, they
own the business. Yeah. Yep. And then similar to the Taco Bell situation we talked about earlier tonight, it's a triple net lease, so they're fully responsible for all maintenance and upkeep and all of that. So
and they weren't interested in the shopping complex behind UDF?
No, part of their new initiative is really expanding beyond centers like that. So they're able to essentially control their real estate a little bit better. And this being a new concept Dollar General Market, it'll have different signage. Branding will be a little bit different, where instead of saying Dollar General real big, it'll say DG Market. And that, again, is the introduction of produce, introduction of meat. Sometimes they'll have a meat cooler for ground beef and some steaks and stuff like that. And the vast majority of the building is more grocery-oriented than maybe others. More coolers, things like that.
Any other comments and questions for Mr. Allen? I appreciate that. So with staff and you are both presenting pretty much aligns.
That's correct.
Yeah, okay.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. I'd like to, do I hear a motion to open the floor for public comments?
I'll make a motion to reopen.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Anyone wishing to speak in favor or against this application, please come to the front and
Kenneth Henning, 4418 Skylark Drive. I have prepared remarks that I have worked on with some residents who have voiced quite a few concerns with this development, so I will just go ahead and read these. In the words of Joni Mitchell, they paved paradise and put up a parking lot. The lyrics from Big Yellow Taxi remind us of the irreversible changes that happen when we prioritize short-term gains over the long-term well-being of our community. In Clayton, we must carefully consider the voices of our neighbors who express concerns about developments like a Dollar General. These types of businesses, while sometimes convenient, often fail to contribute meaningful revenue to the city and can erode the unique character and charm that makes Clayton special. Expanding on this, it's important to recognize that the character of a community is shaped not only by its buildings and businesses, but by our neighbors who live here and their shared vision for the future. Clayton is not just another dot on the map. It's a place where families grow, friendships are forged, and memories are made. Allowing developments like a Dollar General might seem like a small step towards progress, but it's a precedent for more of the same, leading to a slow but steady erosion of our town's unique identity. Is this the legacy we'd like to leave for our city? These kinds of establishments often bring minimal economic benefit and attract transient traffic rather than fostering a vibrant local economy. Moreover, the environmental impact cannot be ignored. Continuing to pave over green spaces for parking lots and cookie-cutter buildings contributes to urban sprawl and diminishes the natural beauty that residents and neighbors cherish. We must ask ourselves, is this the future we want for the city of Clayton? Or do we want a community that values thoughtful development that enhances our quality of life rather than detracting from it? By listening to our neighbors and making careful, deliberate choices, we can ensure that Clayton remains a place we're proud to call home. Let's not pave every part of our Clayton paradise. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Henning. Anybody else wish to make a comment? Yes, sir. Please take your time.
My name is Bruce Whitworth. I live at 6782 Salem Avenue. So I'm my wife and I live in the house to the west, the driveway right before the future potential driveway, I guess, there. But first of all, I didn't know it was a Dollar General store going in there. I don't know how I got to this point in my life and didn't realize they were putting that up or why that isn't something that came before the letter asking if they could get a variance. But my first reaction on hearing it was a Dollar General store was, if you drive around Dayton and look at any Dollar General store, pull in their parking lot and sit for 5 minutes, if you feel safe, if you don't feel like the area has been degraded, if you don't feel threatened in any way, then you're not actually in a Dollar General store. That's my first thought. Secondly, I didn't come to the Casey's meeting. You brought it up. I thought if you want to talk about it sometime, we should talk. But the lighting, light pollution, the noise pollution, empty parking lots at night, even when they close, the lights stay on. We had to change all the curtains in our house, and our house is 450 yards off the road from Casey's. And I love summertime because the property owner right now, they don't take care of that property and it's overgrown. And that's the only thing that allows us to have any peace at all from light pollution. Noise pollution is unending. And that corner, Union and 49, it sounds like a racetrack almost all the time, 2-3 in the morning. People are in Casey's parking lot doing donuts. They're spinning out in the middle of Salem Avenue. They don't care. In the UDF parking lot, in that abandoned parking lot, or that poorly occupied center behind it's so frustrating to live, and we have a small house, but our property is beautiful, and it's like a sanctuary. People come there and say, man, it's like you live out in the country somewhere. You wouldn't know we lived where we live. But then if they're sitting there long enough, they'll hear all that racket, usually from about 4 o'clock until maybe 8. It's up and down the roads, terrible. After that, midnight, 2 in the morning, people will be parked in that Casey's parking lot, parked over in that back parking lot, music cranked up, screaming and yelling, fighting, police up and down that road all the time. It's just has degraded it to the point that we even said we were going to try to buy that property, the two lots that aren't being discussed tonight, just so we could put a fence up and have it just leave it grow wild, just to have some buffer from the onslaught. And I can't imagine if the neighbors who live to the east of us behind that wood line are here, having that place that close, I would be pulling my hair out right now. I don't think that store is the right store for us, but I don't think that location has any business being the location. And that's just my two cents worth. I appreciate your time.
Thank you very much for your input. You did good. Anybody else wishing to speak?
Hello, Amy Matthews. I'm at 6487 Union Road. So we will be right next to this building. We bought the house last year. We got married. Actually, yesterday was our 1-year anniversary. So we bought the house. We have 5 kids. So it has just shy of 3 acres. And everything that you guys described, I won't repeat because you said don't repeat, but times two. We have had several people come to our house and say, it does not seem like you live right here, because we have 3 acres, we have all the trees, we have everything surrounding us. We do have good neighbors, and that is what we use it for. Our kids run, they play hide and seek on our land. It is a little crazy with the noise and them coming up and down, even in the mornings when my kids are getting on the bus at 7 a.m. It's already crazy. I feel like the same guy drives up and down at the exact same time all the time, and I cannot believe there hasn't been already more accidents, because we hear them constantly. My kids get on the school bus right there where the other driver is about to come around, so I'm sure there will be more accidents coming in here. We have the church kids come over and they use our property. We have bonfires for our church kids. We have them come over for several things. We have other church members come over. So that also scares me, that I'm going to have all these church kids at our house. And then we're going to have people coming in from this building that, yes, it does bring sometimes a different clientele in. I mean, everybody uses it, but we also have Trotwood right down the road, which their building, 2.1 miles down the road, their other Dollar General, whatever dollar store it is... not, I mean, there's like one worker in there all the time. My dad lives in Trotwood. He goes in there all the time, and it's not kept up. All the other ones, I know I posted on Facebook, and we had probably 70 people that live in the Northmont area that also agree. If we have all these other ones, why can't they keep them going, keep them stocked, keep workers? If we can't already find workers, why are they going to want to come work in another one? It doesn't make any sense. We would lose our privacy, our safety, all of the driving. We have dogs. So please say you're not going to do this, but if you do, one of the variances, because how close it is, can we have a really tall fence because we have dogs? Also the light. That's our other big concern. My kids' bedrooms are all 3 on the top right there, where all that light is going to shine in. We already have curtains, but it doesn't matter. It's going to be there. So the construction time, how long is this going to take? We're going to be hearing construction for how long? Every morning, I'm sure, and every evening. You know, I know our resale,
the resale of the house is probably going to go down. I don't know necessarily about the value of the house, but our resale, if we ever decide to leave. I don't want to leave Clayton. I've lived here for a long time. I lived in Valley Brook before that. So we've heard all the shootings and everything in there. I was a manager for Casey's. So I know it doesn't get taken care of. That was one of the things I tried to change, and it didn't happen. That's another reason why I left there. I do work for Northmont Schools, so I work in the community. I would like to keep it nice and keep going for our kids, like you said, and like the other gentleman said. I don't feel like this is a good investment for Clayton to do to keep that going. That's my opinion. We also have a septic leach bed right there on the side, so I know you've brought that up several times tonight. The original part of the house was there from like 1919, and that septic right there is like right there on that fence line. What is that going to do with all that stuff coming in there with the trash and everything else? I think that's all I've got. My safety of my kids from people coming in there, walking. We have people walk through our yard all the time. A lot of them are our church kids from the neighborhood behind us. Perfectly fine. We say hello to them. But I do worry about a lot of the walkers right there with that intersection. It's crazy. It is nuts. So there's no way. I know if they try to do this traffic stuff, something has to come up because it's crazy right there. So I know my husband also wants to talk more about the detailed stuff. So I will let him do that.
Ms. Matthews, thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Michael Matthews. I live at 6487 Union Road, Clayton, Ohio. So she talked a lot, but I'd like to look at the pictures, if that's okay, and show a few things. So I'd like to go back to his pictures first, if we could. Keep going. So this one, he talked about the easements. I'm looking at this, I don't see any houses until up here, which is much further than 80 feet. Looking here, same thing. I still don't see anything for 80 feet. Can you go to the next one, past that one? Again, I'm not sure if this is a house or not, but it's definitely not that close from their property. Here we see it a little bit more, but they're all on the other side, far from the road. If you can go back to the blueprint. Yep. So as she was talking, I believe this is the allowable easement, is that correct? 60 feet. You're at 60 feet. I know my house is right here. That leach bed that she was talking about is right here. And this is, I would say, 20 feet from the actual property line. If you can go before this picture. It is a two-story house, that leach bed that we were talking about right here. And I believe, according to their blueprint, this was going to be their flood zone, or like an area for flooding, as well as back here would be the next one. Let's put their trash point right here. If I could show you blueprints of my house right now, I would show you that my bedroom window is right here. In this corner. My living room is right here. She was talking about lights and things like that. We just put, I believe, $10,000 worth of windows in, $17,000 to drown out the racing that happens up here. The other major point that I would like to point out since we're a fifth picker is over in this area, there's a club where there are multiple shootings or have been in the past. And recently, since we bought the house, there was a shooting right here. The only thing stopping my house from getting hit by the AK-47 that went off is this tree line that they want to destroy or take down. I look at criminal activity that can happen here. I apologize. I've been military for 17 years, National Guard, and if I have to leave her and my kids, I'd rather know that they're protected than having their trash point sitting almost on my property line. And I know the statement was to possibly put the parking back here and let them walk across. But I'd rather have that than have this and then take my chances with that parking than have them. And I'll put up their parking back here and their clientele not wanting to walk around to the front over having this trash point here in my house all day long. So we had a few other things. I come from a long line of semi-truck drivers. As I said, I've been in the military for 17 years and I've drove some of the biggest trucks possible. I'm not for sure, according to the blueprint, if you can go back to that. This is their loading dock plan, their entrance. My father is one of the most decorated drivers I can imagine. My uncle is as well. They've drove for over 40 years with a 52-foot trailer on the back of the big rig. It's not fitting in here. And if it does, that driver deserves a huge award. Okay. But then backing into the area, again, which is my living room, what's to say this trucker wasn't on the road for hours and hours? They're tired. They don't stop. How much space is between here and my living room where my kids might be laying? So those are a few of my concerns, and I hope they go far as they can. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Appreciate your comments, Mr. Matthews. Thank you very much. Anyone else?
My name is Nidra Whitworth. I live at 6782 Salem Avenue. My husband already spoke. I guess we're like tag teaming. I have not prepared anything eloquent to say. Just the fact that I have lived at. So when you have the picture where you can see everybody's house, my house is a different one. Keep going. My house is that one. This little bitty piece right here, right on, that's me. My house is 900 square feet. When I bought it, I paid $24,000 for it. It was a HUD house. We have raised the property value. I think it is now somewhere $95,000 in the 11, 12, 13 years that I've lived there. I love where I live. I love being close to access to the world because I teach at Trotwood Madison, and I've taught at Trotwood Madison High School for now 12 years. This isn't a place where I was just going to stop by. This is a place where I wanted to be. Where I'm at, a couple of years ago, I was diagnosed with a neuroendocrine tumor. So I have neuroendocrine cancer in my digestive system. One of the highest triggers is stress. And so we actually have a koi pond that we just built so that I could sit and have a babbling brook to try to get rid of the sound. Casey's is closed in the middle of the night, but that light is in my living room 24 hours a day. So they don't lessen the light at night. And so it is like, so I just want to reiterate the fact that if we're just looking at this as a basis, Clayton is known for being a homey area. This is where people want to settle down. This is where we want to stay because of the environment that it is. There's a grocery store on Union. There's a grocery store on Hoke. There's a grocery store now, GFS. If you go down a little bit further in Trotwood, there's not a single grocery store. So why are we putting yet one more grocery store in a small area where we're just having duplicate businesses? And where it's at, like, I'm not gonna say everything that everybody's been saying, but where I live, I have a small house, but my property is really nice and it's off the road. And where this is at, like, I specifically chose that area because it's off the road. And you can kind of see, like, we've never met. I'm just gonna say we've never met. But I know when they moved in, because the people that lived there before, where they're, this is their backyard right here, and the people who lived here before made this trail a four-wheeler trail. And so when they're running their four-wheeler, that's my living, that's my laundry room right there. And so we know, like, it's really, really loud. We have a really old house, and we can hear everything because our house was built on the corner of our property already, so there's nowhere that I can go. And so I'm just saying, take into consideration how many duplicate businesses we need in the small town of Clayton when Trotwood doesn't have a single grocery store and they're less than 2 miles away. So why are we building yet another structure instead of utilizing what we already have? Sorry.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else, please? Yes, sir.
My name is Greg Fallon, and I live at 6455 Union Road, which is the next property here. Guys, these people build these places, and then they bank the check, and they go away. And this is right in our neighborhood. And trust me, man, I've been up many a night with the businesses that are around. Excuse me, I get nervous speaking like this because I'm really serious about this. There's crime like you wouldn't believe, and we all know that these days it's getting worse. And like I say, these guys build these things, they go on their way, and they leave, they dump them in our neighborhood, and we're supposed to deal with it. Now, I've lived in a place where I live for 20-some years, and I pay good taxes. Clayton has high taxes. I feel like I should have a say in what goes on around here. Now, if we could, and I really hope that you guys will take that to heart, because I, you know, we all, if it's coming next to your house, you probably wouldn't like it either, you know. Now, if you could go back to the plot plan, please. Yep. Now, this line going around here that they're saying is 20 feet in, is that code? Isn't that a variance? Aren't they looking for a variance? Shouldn't that be, this is the Matthews property line here. Shouldn't this line be 60 feet in? I'm just saying, you know, and if that's the case, and it's supposed to be a setback, this dumpster is almost right on their line, right here. We've got a two-lane road right here that's already getting backed up right now from traffic. They got a new plat going in down here, huge new plat. Now, this is coming right out, this is dumping right into that two-lane road. Now, how in the world does that make sense that that's gonna be able to take all that traffic, you know? And what happens at this place at night when it does close down? I'll tell you what will happen. There'll be people hanging out in this parking lot, and we'll see stuff going on all the time. Because that's what goes on. I was a high school kid in this area too, and that's what we used to do. We hung out on Friday nights at the shopping malls and in the parking lots. Now let me see if I can think. I have some more ideas. Because I am a little bit farther from it, but man, I tell you what, you know, I don't know that like I said, I don't know what we have to do in order to, you know, stop this from happening. But I'll tell you something that I see going on right here. I see them trying to put 6 gallons of water in a 5 gallon bucket. I've been in construction for 35 years, in commercial construction and all kinds of construction. That's a bad layout. And like I say, I hope you guys will take that to heart. I believe we should have a say.
Absolutely. And we do appreciate your input, sir. Thank you very much.
I've been paying taxes, you know, I've been living in this area.
Thank you very much. Anybody else?
Shopping center, and if you can go back to the one where it shows all the, you know, I own all this land here, and I own all the land here. And one of the biggest problems that we have is this is one of the greatest drug centers in the country. This one and that one. They come off of Interstate 49 on the 70 on the this, and just check with the police department, find out how many druggies are picked up here and how many druggies are picked up here. When we go into this new site, it's going to even be more accessible because they can whip right around that corner and come on back out. They'll have so many people after hours in that parking lot. You won't be able to count. Flip back to the other drawing, please. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's see. Let's find out where the entrance is. Okay. Entrance is up here. I would like to see the truck driver that can put a 65-foot trailer and semi in this space right here, and then get it out and come back out and exit. And if they're going to exit this way, they're going to be exiting and all that traffic that's coming down this way. And at night, afternoon, they're going to be dealing with all the kids coming out this way. You'll have to sit there at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the afternoon and probably wait for 10 or 15 minutes to get access out of here because of all the traffic there is. Now in this design, they uniquely set up this little cute little access here. And all that is a way for them to develop this property and get it come in and out and use the same exit. Because when they try to build something in here, they're going to require at least one or two exits out here onto Salem Avenue, and rather than put in the other exit, they'll utilize this exception that you're going to allow if you allow it. This is one of the easements they have. One of the other easements is they backed this up so they could put parking out here. This is a little trash loader from inside the trash that they put in, and then this is this dumpster. That's one of the easements that they want. Then they want to use this as a storage area. What kind of storage area? Because that's right across from my stepdaughter's house and her husband. Okay? I don't mind this one as much as I would this one, because it's right. Dogs, and they have a caution fence around here, and just the other day there were people walking down on her property through here to get back to look at this, and she happened to catch them, and she said, "Hey, can you walk on their property? Because I have dogs, and I like to turn them loose, and I know one of the dogs would nail anybody that's in there." And it just violates their property in so many ways. I would be really concerned about coming back from school and coming down the speedway. I got that little walk up. That's my opinion. I hope you take it in consideration.
Mr. Monahan, always a pleasure. Thank you. Anybody else? Certainly.
What about alcohol? Are they going to be selling alcohol there? I'm just, you know, what I'm wondering is if that's the case, what kind of traffic are you going to get from that? Okay?
Understand. Any other last thoughts? Okay. Do I hear a motion to close the floor to public comments?
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter? Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell? Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Allen? Any comments? Now, we're here to talk about a variance,
that's
okay?
Right. Yep.
So I understand that. That's what we're focused in on. However, there's been some issues raised from the neighbors. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to kind of talk about some of the things that were brought up tonight. And you're right. We're here to talk about variances only, not the use per se, because that's permitted by code already. But I know it's a topic of concern, so we're going to talk about it. Mr. Henning had asked or originally brought up, and I think he left, looks like, but economic impact. Now this does create jobs for the community. Every new store creates, you know, varying amounts of jobs, up to 10 typically, at least a store manager, assistant store manager, and then several full and part-time employees. There is impact besides just tax dollars, sales tax and all that. So that was one of his comments. Also heard a lot of discussions and concerns about lighting and noise. Completely understand that. One thing that I don't know if it came across on the plans or if it's read correctly, but the entire southern boundary, as well as, you know, up the west side as well, where we're not building will remain treed. So we're not taking down the whole site. I know that was something that was brought up. You know, and we could even, once we get into the engineering phase of this, look at ways to minimize that stormwater area behind the building to allow for more trees. More than happy to do that. But that's sort of the next step in this process when we get into engineering and we get into those kind of reviews and code requirements. You know, the dumpster location and the truck delivery location were brought up multiple times. Before we do any kind of site planning like this, we run a lot of due diligence, and one of which is actually truck circulation. There's models that do it for you, and then there's also, you know, I built 100 of these. I know how a truck works in these kind of sites. And it can easily maneuver the way we have it shown here. What it does is it comes in, goes up to where the top parking spaces are, and then backs down to where we have the loading area. And it'll go out and then out onto the road that way. So it does have complete circulation within the site. Within ease. So understand the concerns there, because on paper everything looks a little bit different, but in actuality, based on the dimensions that we have here and the configuration, it does work. There were some questions or concerns about detention and how that may impact neighboring properties. So we, like I mentioned before, we have had conversation with Public Works and Stormwater Randy and Stormwater specifically. Basically, our plan is to catch all the water from our development, route it to this triangular stormwater basin, which is not a wet pond, just for clarification standpoint. It's a dry basin that, in a rain event, holds water temporarily and then outlets into public structure. And so it'll go from that triangular one to the one up nearest the entrance and then out into the catch basins that are in the road already. And all of that is done with engineering calculations, with engineering thought, and obviously with communication and approval through the county and the city. So we're just not out there doing things as we wish. You know, they've got to abide by code. So that hopefully would lessen any kind of concern as it relates to maybe those stormwater areas flooding or anything like that, because that's not how they'll be designed. The only other thing that I heard, and maybe, you know, apologize if I missed anything, I was taking notes, is maintaining some sort of barrier between the residential properties and then our site to help lessen the impact of noise and light pollution. Lighting, just in general, we use an LED light that is shielded and it's directed down. And so we have to abide by city code as well as our own tenant criteria of 0-foot candles along the entire property boundary. So no light spillage is what we're held to be required to. The new LED lights, like I said, they're shielded, they go straight down, and so there's not what you might think of as old lighting that just kind of spills out uncontrolled. So that's already in the plans and is a standard, basically. And then along that shared boundary there, like I mentioned, we're gonna keep as many trees as physically possible, and I'm willing to, you know, work with neighbors to maybe pick the best ones to keep or fill in maybe where there is some gaps. I'd also be willing to, you know, talk about a fence and get that in the plan. So we want to be good neighbors. It's always the goal in all of these developments that we work on. We're not out here to, you know, not try to work with anybody.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much for your comments. How far along in planning are we on this?
This is the first step. So obviously we're here asking for the variances. If variances get approved, then we move forward with this plan we see. And then if not, we modify and continue on as well.
Okay, so after this, we would go to the Planning Commission? Okay, where would it go? Okay. So individual staff then would handle their individual responsibilities. Gotcha.
So my understanding is if the variances aren't approved, you're still going to proceed with the development of that area?
That's correct.
Because it's a permitted use here.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Allen. I appreciate that.
All right. Thanks. You. Appreciate it very much.
Mr. Monahan, come up, please. You need to be on record.
Come in here and come out this way. Is there any way that can be eliminated?
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Jim. Okay.
Yeah, for the tension stuff, it's kind of what I already talked about earlier, but once we are able to get it engineered, we'll know exactly how much space we'll need there. Right now, it's a placeholder, essentially, with what the available land has. But yes, it will be piped from one basin to the next, then out. And that's the way we would be required to do it by code. So we can't just tile it and let it go into the storm because it doesn't meet code, essentially.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. I'm sorry, we've already closed public input, and Mr. Monahan went out of turn. That was my apology for that.
I apologize.
This is a public meeting, and I'm not gonna stand in that way. So I appreciate that. Yes, sir.
6487 East Street, Union Road. The only thing that I wanted to say, sir, is that I understand now that you said that if the water would go into the basin here, it would move to the secondary basin. I do believe, if I'm not mistaken, that this is the storm drain. But according to it, we've already had to call the city back out when they did some work here.
Honestly, that is a concern, which is why I was asking where we were in the planning stage, because that is a potential problem. What I would recommend is that we work with staff again. Randy Bollinger is, I believe,
Sanders.
Who?
Sanders.
My bad. Randy Sanders is the person responsible for that. Well, again, we're here to talk about the variances, but like in the conditional use that you guys were patient enough to sit through, there's a lot of discussion going on, and that's okay. So I appreciate you guys making your concerns known. And please feel free to work with the city, because that's why the city's here. Okay, further discussion among us. Thoughts from the board?
Bob. My thoughts are, we have all the residents here saying that they are not in favor of the Dollar General, but I don't know if there is any mechanism in which they can prevent a Dollar General from coming at this stage of the game. However, we've also heard the residents say that they don't like submitted layout, which is what requires a variance. And while to me it seems like it's maybe more logical than putting the parking lot in the back, I think it's the opinion of the residents that matters. So I would be of the mind to not grant this variance and see if the next plan that comes in is perhaps less objectionable.
Thoughts on that, Ms. Snyder?
I wish Mr. Henning hadn't left, because he's the one who would know that stuff.
So it is up to the Board of Zoning Appeals to grant a variance or not grant a variance, and then it is up to the public to appeal that variance granting with the courts.
Thank you.
I think it's going to happen. That's why I asked the question. What we do here, if we reject the variances, is going to force them to build and meet all the standard codes, right? Which could give you some relief in some ways, I would hope. We can't stop that. We can only probably try to vote in a way or put it in a way that will help some of the things, but please understand that, you know, it's the way I understand it, it's going to happen.
I'll give you one more chance.
I just want to reiterate sort of my opening comments about if this is designed by code that puts all the parking closest to the residential areas, which comes light pollution, which comes everything else that they said they didn't like, now it's as close as possible to their homes. And I really, and I'm saying this as a professional, but I also saying it as a father and a husband, I wouldn't want that by my house. And I know it because I can see it in plans I look at every day. I really don't think you're gonna want parking next to your house, a sea of parking, and then the main road in and out of that right next to your house. I think you're gonna want that to be as far towards Salem as possible. So that's just one thing to consider.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Thank you. Appreciate that. Thoughts on the board? Also agree that it's not like we're going to stop this. We're here to discuss the variances. And I agree with Mr. Allen that the variances are there to keep the, or at least to ease the traffic considerations. Appreciate the comments, though. I appreciate the encroachment on our properties. I appreciate intrusion that we're feeling. I appreciate the traffic and the problems that are existing there today. And again, we don't have any jurisdiction over that either, because we're just here to talk about these variances. The variances are to ease this transition to this property that has momentum, that has an approved usage anyway, and it's going to come in. Not much we can do about that except empathize and understand. And I do. I get it. You know, I'm pretty much a lifelong resident of here too. So I know exactly what you're talking about. And the traffic going up and down Salem Avenue is not fun. It's not fun to listen to, and it's increased over time. Union Road is tight. I know that. I know that the traffic volume is increasing because of the neighborhood behind there that's going up all along Westbrook Road, and it keeps developing. You know, keeps developing. Some people call that progress. Some people call it a darn nuisance. What I like to do is go to Montana and try to forget it all, as I'm sure we all would. But we're here to talk about the variances. So, and I appreciate that. I appreciate your understanding, but you do have some empathy. Kenny Henning was here tonight. He's your councilman, I think, that represents that area. Keep chirping, keep talking, okay, and keep asking. You know, why? What else is coming down here? You know, because when you get that knowledge beforehand, you're going to be a lot better poised to be able to handle these issues when they come down the pike. Okay? So keep looking, keep asking, keep being involved, all right? And maybe if you can just make that cross that one T or dot that one I, that'll be a little bit better for you, okay? That's all I can say, you know, but I do appreciate what you're saying. So the business at hand is these variances in front of us. Do I hear who would like to go through and do the findings of fact on this?
Special conditions and circumstances exist which are peculiar to the land, structure, or building involved and which are not applicable to any other land, structure, or building within the same zoning district. Looked on that map, were there not other building lots that had similar problems and issues?
Similar problems, but the way the lot is set up, the way the store is generating, the business and that type of good stuff, those are the special circumstances, I think, to be able to get this in with a minimum of variances to be able to require the usage, proper use of the store.
So we'd say agree. A literal interpretation of the planning and zoning code would deprive the applicant of rights commonly enjoyed by other property owners in the same zoning district under the same provisions of the planning and zoning code. I would say yes, agree.
Say yes, and again, the same zoning district is the business commercial that we're talking about.
Special conditions and circumstances do not result from the actions of the applicant.
Yes, probably the design of the lot, or yes. the size of the lot and the form, the layout, shape of the lot. Yeah.
Granting the variance requested will provide the minimum necessary relief to alleviate the practical difficulties the applicant is experiencing. Yes.
Yes, and as we heard, the actual, they could do this without the variances, but it would exacerbate the impact on the neighbors.
Granting the variance will be in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the planning and zoning code and will not cause damage or harm to the neighborhood or otherwise be detrimental to public health, safety, and welfare.
Disagree with that as well.
The proposed variance will not constitute a change of zoning district, including a variation in use on the official zoning map. In no case shall the board approve a variance for the use which is not a permitted use in the zoning district in which the land, structure, or building is located. Other relevant factors that may assist the board in weighing and balancing the public and private benefits and harms to determine if the requested relief is necessary, with the exception that no nonconforming use of neighboring land, structures, or buildings in the same zoning district, and no permitted of nonconforming use of land, structures, or buildings in any other zoning district shall be considered justification for approval of the requested variance. I agree with that.
Agree.
Talk about possible conditions to put on approval of the variance that would help out the neighbor's situation. Mm-hmm. Any suggestions?
I suggest that the developer looks at the concerns of the neighbors that were vented tonight with thought toward trying to minimize the impact of the Dollar General. On the neighborhood, on the traffic. directly with the neighbors who potentially have leach beds and septic systems to the south, working with the city of Clayton to ensure that the water flow from the catch basin area, triangular catch basin we were talking about, to the service under Union Road apparently is done properly, and that any shielding is put in as if possible, you know, working with the neighbors to ensure that they're shielded from noise, lights, and other dangers along those lines. What am I missing? Yeah, minimize delivery, trash pickup to business hours, if at all possible. Again, we can't put qualifications really on the use, but we are trying to address the neighbors' needs here. When it comes to police and fire, I recommend the neighbors call 911 when you hear this activity and see what's going on over there, and just see what's going on. You got to protect your own neighborhood, and that's one way of doing it. You know, City of Clayton, when there's a demand for service and as it increases, you'll get more visibility. I would recommend that you do that to try to help the situation. Boy, it's tough. I know it's tough. We have a motion. No, we don't. We have a findings of fact. Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion.
We need to approve the variance with the additions and conditions as recommended to the builder.
I will make a motion that we approve, but I want to make a comment here. I think approving these variances to me is helping in a way that it's going to give you the less of the evils. I mean, because if the parking goes in the back, if we make them stay with the zoning variations, the parking's going to go in the back. And I just, personally, I wouldn't want that. So I think, in my case, difficult decision, but I'm making that motion based on what I perceive as what's best for you. Does that make sense? I hope so.
I'll second that. Okay. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Hunter?
Yes.
Mr. Madewell?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
No.
And Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
We made it. Holy mackerel, 10:45. Do I hear a motion do we have anything coming up for next month?
No.
Okay. Except
the one we just tabled.
Except for the one we tabled, but that's all right.
I might withdraw it.
Do I hear a motion then to adjourn?
Motion.